Begins at 8 Eastern and Pacific with Rupert Murdoch, Bill Moyers at 8:45, and Martha Rogers at 9:30. Book Notes, Sunday night at 8, and Prime Minister's Questions at 9 Eastern and Pacific.
A year ago this month, TWA Flight 800 crashed shortly after its takeoff from New York City's Center's Kennedy Airport, killing all 230 on board. Yesterday, a House Transportation Subcommittee heard from officials from the National Transportation Safety Board, FBI, and the Federal Aviation Administration about the investigation. Due to some technical difficulties, we're unable to bring you the first 90 minutes of the hearing. We begin the hearing as federal investigators discuss their plan to duplicate the conditions of the flight through tests on a Boeing 747.
We want to proceed once again with the hearing, and Mr. Lipinski has made a request or a suggestion that we originally granted a request from the NTSB to allow separate testimony, but we were maybe under the misimpression that there was a little more of a conflict than there is, and Mr. Hall's testified that the agencies are all working together. Mr. Lipinski has stated to me that his questions that he wishes to ask at this point, he would like also to ask of the FBI and the FAA. And so what I'm going to do is to request that Mr. Kallstrom and Mr. Gardner come up to the table at this point, and we're going to go ahead and proceed with their testimony. And then we will turn to Mr. Lipinski for his questions, as well as questions from other members when they return from this vote. We are pleased to have, as we've had with us before, Mr. James K. Kallstrom, who is Assistant Director in charge of the New York Office of the Federal Bureau of Investigation, and Mr. Guy S. Gardner, who is Associate Administrator for Regulation and Certification of the Federal Aviation Administration. And we ordinarily proceed in the order in which they're listed on the notice of hearing. And so, Mr. Kallstrom, that means that we will hear from you at this time, sir. Thank you very much for being with us.
Good morning, Mr. Chairman. Morning, members of the committee. Thank you for inviting me to be here today to represent the FBI and to give you a broad overview of the FBI's investigation of the tragedy of TWA Flight 800. As this matter continues to be an active criminal investigation on our part, I know you'll appreciate the restrictions that are placed on the FBI and will understand the limits this fact may impose on my statements and responses. When this catastrophic tragedy happened on the night of July 17, 1996, and after initial information indicated that all communications from TWA Flight 800 were normal and the no distress calls were issued, the FBI, as well as most of the world, believed that there was a possibility that this tragedy was the work of criminals or terrorists. As you are aware, in the first few hours following this tragedy, over 100 individuals reported seeing events in the sky associated with TWA Flight 800. That is why the FBI and the law enforcement team acted, and acted quickly, to begin a massive, thorough criminal investigation. If there was ever a chance that this tragedy was criminal, it was critical that the proper investigation take place immediately. From the beginning, the FBI's investigative purpose has been to reach what I have called in the past critical mass, to gather sufficient evidence to allow us to state with a high degree of certainty whether this tragedy was the result of a criminal act, and if so, determine who was responsible and bring them to justice. Our efforts have been and continue to be focused on two primary criminal theories: that the destruction of Flight 800 was the result of a bomb placed on the aircraft or a missile fired at it. The FBI's investigation has been one of the most massive, thorough, sophisticated, and costly ever conducted by our agency. The FBI has expended tens of thousands of hours of agent resources participating in body recovery operations, wreckage recovery, storage, scientific examination and analysis by FBI scientists as well as outside experts. Part of this effort has been the largest reconstruction of an aircraft ever undertaken. To date, the FBI has conducted over 7,000 interviews. Our investigation has included interviews of ground crews and mechanics in New York and Athens, passengers and crew who were on the flight from Athens to New York that preceded Flight 800, hundreds of witnesses on Long Island and surrounding areas, witnesses on other aircraft who observed the explosion, and military personnel. A review of information available from intelligence assets, tracking of all air and waterborne vessels in the area at the time of the explosion, followed by appropriate interviews and tracing of all reports of stolen boats, stolen motor vehicles, and suspicious incidents during the period of time preceding and after the tragedy, and many, many other investigative techniques. In short, our investigative efforts have been exhaustive. All of our efforts to date have failed to uncover any credible evidence that the loss of Flight 800 was a result of a criminal act. Let me again reiterate something I told the committee in the briefing several months ago, in which I have publicly stated. Flight 800 was definitely not brought down by friendly fire. That is, no missile or any other action by the military and naval forces of the United States caused this tragedy. We continue to examine the possibility that the aircraft was destroyed by a bomb, a terrorist missile, or other criminal act. Each day we move closer to completing leads and other lines of inquiry seeking to close out theories and resolve the questions of possible criminal activity. We have not reached the end of our investigative process, and the theories of a bomb or terrorist missile, along with the possibility of mechanical failure, are still on the board. Barring some new disclosure of information, we are now in the final phase of that investigation. We have several lines of inquiry or action items left to complete, so that we can ensure that we have covered every base and that the families of the victims and the American people will be confident that our ultimate determination is based on the most thorough, most exhaustive, finest investigation that the FBI and the law enforcement team can produce. For example, we've identified, cataloged, and conducted a close scientific examination with NTSB of almost 200 holes, slits, punctures, penetrations identified in the reconstructed areas of the airplane. We expect that the metallurgy analysis and our other remaining leads may be completed as early as 60 to 90 days from today. We don't know that for sure. However, as I stated earlier, none of the analysis completed to date has uncovered any evidence whatsoever of a crime. In the next 60 days, we expect to have the final results of a sophisticated analysis of the statements of witnesses who reported seeing what has generally been characterized as something ascending into the sky followed by an explosion. This analysis, which includes correlation of what the witnesses saw, what they heard, and their locations with known radar trackings of the aircraft, is extremely detailed and has involved a number of re-interviews. When completed, we believe this analysis will provide a clear understanding of these critical eyewitness observations. Mr. Chairman, throughout this entire investigation, the cooperation between the FBI, NTSB, the United States Navy, the United States Coast Guard, the FAA, the ATF, state and local agencies, and other many other members of the law enforcement team has been nothing but superb. In my entire career in law enforcement, coming up on 28 years, I've worked many major investigations involving multiple agencies, and I can tell you, Mr. Chairman, and the other members of the committee, that I have never seen a case of this significance with this many agencies where the cooperation, professionalism, and can-do attitude was better displayed. The American people can be proud of the dedicated men and women that have labored for almost 1 year from all the agencies and organizations with one idea in mind, and that is to find the cause of this horrendous tragedy. To sum up, Mr. Chairman, we have a number of significant investigative, scientific, and analytical initiatives which we hope to complete within the next 60 to 90 days. The FBI's exhaustive investigative efforts have not uncovered any evidence that the destruction of Flight 800 resulted from a criminal act. It's critically important, I believe, that the investigative team representing the question, was this or wasn't it a criminal act, be methodical, be redundant, look at every possibility, no matter how remote, and that's the stage we're in now. Can you imagine if we looked at this accident and looked at what we normally see, unfortunately, or what we would expect to see, and did not look over and over and over again at every possibility before we made a decision, and later on found out that it was a very sophisticated criminal act, I think myself personally, I'd be terribly embarrassed, and as would every of the thousands of other people that worked on this. So that is why we're taking the time. That is why we're doing the hundreds and hundreds of things that we need to do to reach the conclusion. We're doing it as fast as we can, but we are not going to meet some artificial deadline. We're going to do what we have to do. And when we have that answer, we'll say so. So I thank you very, very much for your time and for your support and for having us here today. And I'd be happy to answer any questions at the appropriate time.
Thank you very much, Mr. Kallstrom. I know that everything looks easy from a distance, and this has certainly been a difficult inquiry for the NTSB, the FBI, and all persons concerned with it. Mr. Gardner.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I have a written statement that I've already submitted for the record. I'd like to summarize that in view of the many comments already made today.
That will be placed in the record.
Thank you, sir. First, I'd like to point out at the start the tremendous effort and echo of the comments already made that have made by the many, many dedicated people in the many agencies involved in the investigation of this accident. The NTSB has worked very diligently to solve this accident and to help find ways to make this accident not happen again and reduce the probability of other accidents happening. The FAA has worked very hard to support the NTSB in their role of investigating this accident. I'd like to point out some of the things that the people in the FAA have been doing in their work to support the board in the investigation of this accident. I was not in this job at the time of the accident, but at that time, along with Chairman Hall and others, people in my organization were notified of the accident. And Tom McSweeney, who you'll meet later on this morning, will be with me in the question period. His organization met early the next morning, 4:15 Seattle time, to begin their work to help the board determine the cause. In the first few months of the investigation, we had at least 100 people or more spent well over 13,000 hours of time supporting the board in their investigation of this accident. They did a thorough review of the 747, both the design certification criteria that had been gone through at the beginning of the airplane, as well as the history of the airplane and all the service bulletins and design changes that it made, in the hopes of finding some clues that might lead us to any cause of this accident. They did find some areas of concern and gave those areas of concern to the board as possible scenarios that might have caused this accident for the board to continue to investigate. We also have in the FAA the responsibility of what we call continued airworthiness. What that means is the fleet is out there today, 35,000 commercial flights flying today, flying tomorrow, the next day. And we have a responsibility to our customers, the American people, to make sure that those aircraft meet the very high levels of standards of safety that we demand from them. So I have an organization of people who work 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, very dedicated people, to ensure that we've got the safest air transportation system in the world and that we can make it safer when we can. So as part of this investigation and part of that responsibility, when we do discover and when the board comes up with possible scenarios, we look at those and say, even if we don't know those are the cause of this accident, could they cause an accident? And we've taken steps in a couple of areas that are in my statement to actually look at those causes and ensure, and actually took some preventive measures to ensure that those particular causes, whether or not they were the specific cause of this accident, will not cause future accidents. Of course, the board did give us their recommendations in December, as has been discussed, and we take those recommendations very seriously. Back in the 70s, the FAA looked very hard, did a lot of research in the hopes of coming up with techniques that would reduce the possibility of flammable vapors in aircraft fuel tanks. A lot of work was done. However, the conclusion of that work, we could not come up with some viable solutions for the commercial aviation industry. In the nearly 100 years of aviation, we have lived with flammable vapors in fuel tanks, just as we do in the fuel tanks of our cars and in the home heating systems in our homes. So we have had the requirement to eliminate ignition sources. We worked very hard to do that, and I think when you look at history, with the board's work in investigating past accidents and the support of the FAA, we have learned a lot of lessons and have made great strides in reducing the ignition sources in fuel tanks. TWA 800 is, however, a stark reality of the fact that we have not eliminated them all. The board and the FAA both agree, and I admit, with strong encouragement from the board to cause me to understand that it's time to relook to see if it is, with the new technologies and new knowledge we have gained over the recent years, can we come up with ways to reduce and or eliminate flammable vapors in fuel tanks. Chairman Hall has already briefed you on a lot of the work that is going on under their leadership to look at the investigation and technologies and flight tests to determine specific characteristics of fuel. We have our notice for comments out in the Federal Register in April, asking the world, all the experts in the world, let's put our thoughts together and see, can we come up with some techniques to solve the issue of flammable vapors. Those comments are due to us on August 1st. In those recommendations, as Chairman Hall has mentioned, we are working very hard with them, and I think on most of them they agree that we are doing good work in supporting them and the efforts on our own to solve these problems. And some very few specific short-term recommendations, the board asked us to look at specific procedures that could be put in the near term that would eliminate or reduce these volatile vapors. We have looked very hard at those procedures. Some we had actually looked at back as early as last October. Unfortunately, we have not come up with any procedures to date that, based on the technical data we have to date, show us that we could reduce the flammable vapors in the tanks. There is a small disagreement. It's a technical disagreement within the FAA and the board, and I think Chairman Hall has characterized it appropriately in the fact that it is, in our cooperation and work with each other, it is not a sign of a breakdown in relationships between the board and the FAA. It is a technical disagreement among technical people. Chairman Hall has a lot of very highly qualified, dedicated technical people on his staff, as I do as well. And sometimes we disagree. And we are continuing to gather data to help us work together to find out, are there some good technical solutions to these problems that we face? So in summary, I'd like to say that there is, echo the word said, actually, that there is a lot of effort going on by a lot of people and a lot of organizations who are very dedicated to solving this accident so that we can ensure that we can prevent this accident from happening again and future accidents of any cause in the future. And I share the frustration, and my people share the frustration that I know the NTSB shares, and all of industry, and all the American public. And particularly, I think, the frustration of the families and loved ones of those who died in TWA, who really want to know what caused this accident so we can get closure on this particular event and ensure that it doesn't happen again. And I look forward to questions later, sir.
Thank you very much, Mr. Gardner. Mr. Lipinski.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. First of all, I want to say that I think that the FBI, the NTSB, and the FAA really have worked very, very long, very hard, very diligently on this accident. And it's unfortunate that in the media we have had some apparent differences of opinion between the FAA and the and TSB, but I think that that is bound to happen when you are working on an issue such as this and you are working as long and as hard as you are on it. And I really want to compliment the three agencies here for the work that they have done. I have read over a great deal of information pertaining to this particular accident, and it is very frustrating to me that as of yet we still don't have an absolute positive concrete answer for why this accident occurred. And I only do it sporadically. Those of you who are working on it day in and day out and putting in all this time and energy, you really have to be very frustrated with the fact that we have not conclusively come up with the concrete answer that we are all looking for. And it certainly has to be very, very disappointing to the family members of the victims of this crash also. But I do have confidence that in the very near future, we will come up with why this accident occurred. But I do have some questions that I would like to ask at this particular time. Mr. Gardner, you stated that the technical data available to the FAA indicates that additional fuel will not eliminate the volatile fumes that are said to be the cause of the TWA accident. In addition, you state that there is a significant doubt that any amount of fuel added to the center fuel tank, as recommended by the board, that's the NTSB, would lower the temperature to the point that no explosion would occur. On what do you base this opinion?
Yes, sir. The opinion is based on our technical analysis of the available fuel flammability data that we have. It was been in handbooks for several years developed. I might add that last October, when I first took this job, then Administrator David Henson had looked at some data based on a Boeing flight test in August that indicated that we might be able to add an amount of fuel to the tank to prevent the explosive vapors. He tasked me to find out what that amount was. I, of course, tasked Tom McSweeney, who I have with me here now, and his team in Seattle to determine that amount. The answer they came back with is there is no amount that we can do that when you look at the fuel flammability charts, that the lower explosive limit of temperature is lower than we can get the fuel. I apologize, sir. This is I can go into a lot more detail if you'd like me to on an understanding. I have a chart.
Well, I'd appreciate if you go into a little bit more detail, because so far what you've told me, I've read in other places, but I have to tell you in all candor, I still don't quite understand it. So I'd appreciate if you did go into a little more detail.
I see
you have a chart there. Maybe the chart will help us.
Well, let me try to, first of all.
I mean, if you want anyone else to explain it, it's fine.
I can address the chart, sir, and I will do it. Before I get to the chart, let me explain, hopefully very briefly, and in terms that you can all understand, because I've tried to develop in terms that I can understand, the characteristics of fuel vapors. First of all, I learned a long time ago that the fuel triangle, you need three things. You need fuel, you need oxygen, you need heat. In the case of an explosion in a fuel tank, the fuel and the oxygen are represented by the fuel vapors in the tank. And then the heat is an ignition source in this case. For those fuel vapors to be flammable, they need to be a certain ratio of fuel molecules to oxygen molecules. And the way I kind of try to think of that is when I was a Boy Scout and went camping and was taught how to make campfires out in the field, I knew that I could not take a whole bunch of big logs and stick them in the fire pit and put a match to it and expect it to work. That's kind of like having too much fuel molecules in the vapor. We call that fuel rich, too rich. On the other hand, I can't take some little twigs and just scatter them around the campfire floor and light one of the twigs and expect the fire to go. That's the same thing as I don't have enough fuel molecules in the vapor to keep igniting each other. That's called too lean of a mixture. We do the same thing as in our cars when we tune the fuel injectors or the carburetors. You want it the right amount. You don't want it too lean and you don't want it too rich, or your car doesn't work. Now, that amount of mixture, when it's in a fuel tank, is affected by the temperature in the tank. You can think of it this way. If I have a puddle of water out in the street and it's on a cold day, that water takes a long time to evaporate. It's on a hot day, it evaporates very much quicker. So the hotter the fuel, the more fuel molecules get up into vapor. When I wash the dishes and I rinse them, I like to rinse them in hot water because they dry quicker, and then I don't have as much time drying with a towel. Same kind of principle. So there is a range of temperatures at which a fuel tank will have explosive vapors, that the right amount of fuel molecules are with the oxygen molecules that will allow an explosion to occur. So there's a temperature range. There's another effect, which is altitude, on that temperature range. As you know, as you boil water, as you go up to altitude, the temperature at which the water boils is lower. That's why you have to cook things longer if you're cooking them by boiling at altitude, because the temperature is not as hot. The same effect with that fuel range in fuel is I go to altitude, that temperature range gets cooler. And there's one more effect. You can hang in with me, please. Is if I take that fuel tank at any given temperature and say it's too cold to have enough molecules up in the vapor to be flammable. It's below the lean fuel ratio limit. Well, if I take that tank and shake it up, more molecules are going to get out of the liquid into the vapor, and therefore the mixture will be enriched. And so by shaking it, I lower that cold temperature where it's too lean. I hope that's a good basis for you.
I think that's fantastic. Now, if we could replay that tape one more time, maybe I could understand it all. I understood a great deal of it, and I very much appreciate you explaining that to me and everyone else here who is interested in it. You were going to say something else?
Well, and this chart is a graphical portrayal of that, of what I just tried to explain to you. Mm-hmm. Where we have, Tom, would you point to the static area? The two solid lines are those lower, the lean limit and the rich limit, if my tank is sitting still. You can see there's a wide range down at the bottom, which actually is in centigrade, but it starts there at about 110 degrees Fahrenheit and goes up to nearly 200 degrees Fahrenheit. That's a static tank of fuel on the ground. As you go up to altitude, Tom's doing the wrong thing. Going to altitude, you can see those lines slope to the left. The dashed line over to the left represent how much that lower limit can move to the left into the colder temperatures if I have vibrations in the tank, which obviously occurs when you're flying airplanes around.
I was studying that chart yesterday, and if I had had your explanation yesterday, I may have been able to understand that chart on my own, but I never did come to any concrete understanding of that chart in studying it yesterday. I almost called Mr. Aviation, Mr. Oberstar, to explain it to me, but I got deterred. Mr. Hall, how do you respond to this assertion? If the FAA technical data is accurate, would the NTSB's recommendations prevent an accident like TWA 800? Do you have enough data to know for sure?
Congressman Lipinski, let me make a couple of general comments, and then I will turn it to Dr. Loeb to get into this into more technical areas. First of all, as I said at the beginning, I have a great deal of respect for the FAA, and when we work with them together on major aviation accidents, there are pressures that are put on both organizations. However, as Congress presently has it structured under statute, we are the lead agency and responsible for the investigation of major aviation accidents. Our concern with this discussion that was just held, and I have with me Dr. Merritt Birky, who is the head of the Fire and Explosive Unit, that is the group that worked in charge of this area and the investigation. None of this information, all of this information that was being discussed, was discussed internally within the FAA and was not discussed as part of the investigation. I do not know whether the FAA itself reached outside its own agency. One of the purposes, of course, of having the NTSB as the independent agency in charge of the investigation is to ensure that neither the manufacturer, the operator, the regulator, or the certificator of a particular product are the ones investigating themselves when an accident occurs. Therefore, I did have concern, and I had expressed that in a conversation this week with Secretary Slater, that the procedures that were followed in this particular matter that was just discussed. Now, in addition to that, Dr. Loeb has, and our technical people, Mr. Birky and Mr. Clark and Dr. Ellingstad, who are with me, have a technical difference of opinion, which we would appreciate if you would give us the time to express that technical disagreement. My difficulty here, which I have expressed and I think is understood, is that my responsibility to this chairman, to this Congress, to this committee, is that we independently are in charge of this investigation, and things in connection with this investigation are done in coordination with our agency.
As Guy Gardner has indicated, this chart does give you a picture of when a hypothetical fuel, in this particular case we're talking about Jet A, will become explosive, and the temperature conditions and altitude conditions under which it will become explosive in two possible ranges. One is the static range, the other, and then you can move to lower temperatures at a given altitude if you get a dynamic condition, and that is if you get vibration in the tank. We've known this for a while. There are a couple problems. One is that this chart is based on data that were produced in the 1970s. Jet A fuel is not Jet A fuel, even more so than some other fuels. Part of what we are doing is at the at Caltech and at the University of Nevada, Reno, is to do tests to determine what current Jet A, and in specific, the fuel at Athens and the fuel at JFK, where they would fall on this chart, where in the range. And they're probably not going to fall terribly differently on the static end.
Could I just interrupt you just for one
yes.
second? I hate to do this, but the characteristics of jet fuel, I understand, change from batch to batch. I assume that makes the situation that we are discussing here much more difficult to resolve. A question, though, I have, and you don't have to answer it right now, but I'd like you to answer it when you finish your explanation, or anyone, is why can't we get a real standard on jet fuel? Please
continue. All right. I'll answer the first part of it. Yes, it makes it much more difficult, and it's not just that batch to batch, but it's the ingredients that happen to be in any given batch, additives if they are there, like anti-static additives or other additives, contamination. If there is any water in it or other materials in it, all of these things make a difference. As to why we can't get a standard, I'll let the regulatory agency, Guy Gardner, address that. What I'd like to, just the point I would like to make is two points. One is, if you're in the static range, then very clearly the recommendations we made would have most likely eliminated the TWA accident and also probably the Philippines 737 accident, which was another center fuel tank accident. I think our experts in fuels, the PhDs that we have who spend their lives doing this, agree with us on that part of it. One of the issues that has been raised is if you get into the dynamic level. Let me say a couple other things. Very little is known in a dispositive way about what we're talking right now, and I want that point to be made because we are spending large sums of money doing research in laboratories. We're going to do explosive tests. We are doing flight tests that are beginning on this week and will probably take place, the actual flights, at the end of the week. To learn more about Jet A fuel, about how fuel tanks behave, temperatures, and all of the things that we need to know to really resolve this problem. But having said that, if you're in the static range, there is little doubt that adding additional fuel would have precluded this particular accident. Whether it would create another accident at a higher altitude, I don't know, but we'll go into that in a second. The disagreement, as I understand it, is over the dynamic range. We are in the process during the flight test that we're going to be doing at the end of this week. We have instrumented the fuel tank of the 747 that will be flown to determine the vibrational characteristics of the tank. Our calculations and what we have estimated so far, not having the flight test data, is that you cannot get into the dynamic range based on experimental data that we have on the fuels and on what it would take to actually produce this lower range without probably destroying structurally the fuel tank.
Said we're also talking about a different mechanism of ignition in the dynamic versus the static ranges of these fuels. Another issue is that we have relatively little information here in terms of the particular conditions that existed in the tank of TWA 800 and the importance of the flight test, as Dr. Loeb has indicated, is very critical in terms of determining that. You had raised the question of differences in compositions of fuel from batch to batch. Unfortunately, it's even more complicated because within a particular batch of fuel, there's differences in compositions dependent upon the ratio, how full the tank is, the ratio of vapor to liquid, and as a function of temperature. So that the kinds of hydrocarbons that come off and that are available for ignition vary as a function of altitude, as a function of temperature, and certainly we have reason to believe that a very important part of this problem is the static explosive limit of Jet A fuel, and we believe that the alteration of the volume of fuel in that tank would affect that parameter very importantly.
Let me touch on that issue that Dr. Ellingstad just raised, which is important, and that is the energy levels. What it takes to produce an explosion in this tank is very simple. You need an explosive vapor in the ullage above the fuel, above the liquid fuel. That requires temperature and altitude conditions. The second thing you need is energy. You need something that will ignite the vapor once it's in a flammable range. Now, in the dynamic conditions that I was talking about, which we think probably won't exist, and we won't know that until these flight tests are taken. However, if you get into the dynamic range, what happens is you get a sloshing and a frothing of the liquid fuel. You get a misting, and then you get bubbles coming up from which the air vapor, you can produce a vapor, but most importantly, what you produce is a mist. To ignite that takes more energy than to ignite the vapor. We are right now having a very difficult time finding sufficient energy to ignite the vapor, let alone a mist. So we have two reasons for believing scientifically that it is not likely you will get into the dynamic conditions, and I think that really is at the heart of the difference between the two agencies.
I thank you very, very much. Mr. Gardner, we'll wait until my next round, and you can tell me about the standard on the jet fuel, why we can't get to it, because my time is has been far exceeded. Is there anything you want to say, though, in conclusion before I give my time back to the chairman?
No, sir. I think they've expressed our technical disagreement.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Lipinski. Mr. Blunt.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Mr. Gardner, on that same issue, not to talk about the combustibility of fuel or anything, don't you add another element of risk in when you begin to fuel loaded planes with frequency? Is that a totally safe thing to do, to bring the fuel truck out to do the fueling right there with a plane loaded full of people?
Yes, sir. That does happen out there in the fleet, particularly when you look at the hubs that have the very short turnarounds. The refueling procedures are designed to be safe, that it will not cause any danger to the passengers on board the airplane.
And so you have no record of
of ground refueling accidents that we'd need to be concerned about if you did begin to cool off the fuel?
There have been accidents. I think one of the ones that the that is in the our notice that was referred to earlier in the Philippines, Ernie?
Yes, the Philippines.
In the Philippines was actually the ignition source there was a due to the ground refueling equipment in some. That one wasn't. There have been ignition sources by ground.
I'm assuming some analysis of that would be an important part of deciding whether that would become standard procedure or not, whether there's more chance of fueling accidents than there are these kind of explosive accidents of planes already full of people, already on the ground, all the equipment running, air conditioners and other things, right at the point where people are fueling. Dr. Loeb?
You're absolutely correct about that. I mean, that's a very real issue, and we've looked into it. Fortunately for the American flying public, the FAA has done a very good job addressing that issue. There had been ground refueling accidents in which the fuel tanks have exploded with very serious consequences, the airplanes destroyed.
So if you look at the 13... military non-combat fuel tank explosion experiences going back to the 1970, of that number, six were attributed to a fuel pump malfunction, five to electric arcing, one to lightning, and another to pump wires. If you look at the 13 commercial incidents going back to 1959, six occurred in the course of ground fueling and ground refueling and maintenance associated with an electrostatic charge established, and another case of lightning. And then, of course, the TWA 800 has not been determined. It seems to me the response of FAA over all this time has been to eliminate or reduce ignition source. And the focus of the NTSB recommendations in the aftermath of TWA 800 has been on reducing or eliminating or controlling or, as it's called, inerting the flammable vapors. It seems to me you two agencies should not be having a hissy fit over this. You ought to get together and settle it. Testimony that was very, very thoughtful and scientifically set forth by Mr. Hall says, we believe more can be done to reduce the possibility of another fuel tank explosion. The probability is already very low, but if it might be made lower without significant cost, we believe that effort should be made. Have you determined that the probability can be made lower without significant cost?
First, Congressman, if I could, I'd like to have I'd ask Dr. Birky, who is more our expert on auto ignition, to comment, and then Dr. Lowe will specifically answer, or Mr. Gardner, that question.
Well, as we understand it, presently, the auto ignition temperature of that fuel is in the order of what you said, about 400 degrees. We have no evidence, and as was pointed out by Mr. Gardner or Mr. McSweeney, the temperature under that tank is considerably below that, and the surface temperatures that have been measured to date on a commercial aircraft in that area would indicate that's correct. You cannot get the temperature high enough in the tank to have auto ignition of that fuel.
Now, I commend the board for having gone back to Greece and obtained samples of the fuel that was loaded aboard that aircraft and tested that fuel, because that fuel probably conformed to the British standard rather than to the U.S. Standard for jet fuel on board aircraft, and could well have been high volatility rather than the low volatility fuel used in U.S. aircraft, correct?
Well, there is a bit of a difference in the volatility of the Athens fuel versus the U.S. fuel, but it's not very different in terms of flammability. It turned out to be roughly 114 degrees Fahrenheit versus about 125 degrees Fahrenheit. and the flash point or the auto ignition point would not be much different than what we have in this country.
All right, so now the aircraft is taken off and there would be some agitation of the remaining fuel in the center fuel tank, and there is a presumption that there was a presumption in the past that agitation would have the effect of possibly lowering the explosive quality of the fuel, but testing has indicated that the flash point could be lowered by tank agitation. Is that correct, Mr. Loeb?
That is correct, but Dr. Birky may want to add to that.
I don't have an awful lot of time here. The chairman's being very generous with his time. I'm trying to get to who's doing the right thing. I think you're both agencies are trying to do the right thing. You're both trying to get to the right point. Six events since 1959 in commercial airliners occurred on the ground during refueling due to an electrostatic charge, or at least electrostatic charge as a contributing factor. It seems to me that the thrust of FAA regulatory action has been to deal with the ignition source over all these years. And the recommendation made by the board in the aftermath of TW-800 has been to focus on the on actions to eliminate or reduce the flammability of vapors in the tank. Now, what caused FAA not to act on that recommendation?
Yes, sir. It has been portrayed that the board is looking at flammable vapors and the FAA is looking at ignition sources. I would like to clear that up. The board and the FAA are both looking at both.
I believe that. I understand that.
As I mentioned in my opening comments,
I was talking about emphasis.
I think we emphasize both. Based on technologies of the past, we tried to find methods to eliminate the vapors, and we're unsuccessful in finding that way. That's why we've had such a fierce look at eliminating the ignition source. The probability of an explosion is based on the probability of there being flammable vapors times the probability there's an ignition source. Up to this point in history, there are flammable vapors. The probability is one. So we try to make the ignition source incredibly small, which I think recent history, prior to TW-800 and even since, show that probability is small, although it's not zero, and that unfortunately is what resulted in the TWA-800 explosion. So if that's a small number, 10 to the minus 8th, whatever the statisticians might call that number, if we can just make the probability of the fuel tank explosion, fuel vapors being there, 1/10 of what it is, that'll take that overall number of 10 to the minus 8th and make it 10 to the minus 9th. A step in safety, and we're looking at that with the board, I think, to eliminate, make both of those numbers as small as we can.
Is experience from 707, 727, 737s, DC-8s transferable to 747s in the center fuel tank experience?
I don't understand.
There have been
the
only two 747 center fuel tank. Before this incident, no, including this incident, there are only two 747 incidents. One was an Iranian military tanker struck by lightning. The center tank exploded. And then TWA.
That was a wing tank, a main tank explosion.
Main tank explosion, yes. So, all the other experiences, has the FAA just decided that fuel tank experience on other type and model of aircraft are different from 747s?
Let me have Tom McSweeney answer it. I think he understands your question better than I do. Let me say that the board's recommendations cover all the aircraft out there, and we will be investigating ways to not just do 747s, although we're focusing on them,
But we're looking at the entire fleet of commercial aviation. Let me let Tom
That'd be my comments. Last. You've been very generous, Mr. Chairman.
The curve or the data that you have, I'm sure, is from our notice, and that data was generated within a week or a week and a half from the accident. We spent a lot of time looking at it. One of the things that is important when analyzing that data is the military experience. Until recently, military had JP4. It's a far more volatile fuel. Another important thing is when you look at some of the accident reports, where they talk about fuel pumps being a problem, you will find out that the fuel pump that was put in the airplane was different than the fuel pump that the airplane was delivered with. It was an aftermarket breakout fuel pump that was designed differently, was protected differently.
In each of the six incidents?
I don't know all the six of them, but I can remember two or three where that was in fact the case. In fact, there was one fairly recently in Milwaukee that was the case. And the protection that is designed into those pumps for the civilian market was for some reason not there. But as far as the transferability of the data, that's an important point and one we have looked at. The McDonnell Douglas products do not have air conditioning units underneath the center fuel tanks. Boeing products do, most Airbus products do. So there is some transferability there. One of the things we noticed when we first looked at that data was a striking absence of McDonnell Douglas and Lockheed airplanes from that list. And we did a thorough analysis of all the parameters of fuel tanks, fuel lines, wires in tanks, everything that would go into a tank or attached to a tank between McDonnell Douglas, for instance, and Boeing and Airbus, to see if there was a little gem of design philosophy that was maybe present with one manufacturer that the other manufacturer had engineered out. We have not, we since have looked at that two or three times, and we really haven't seen a huge difference. All the manufacturers seem to be using common engineering, well-understood practices.
In fact, the two or three Douglas aircraft incidents, two were during maintenance when some ignition source was caused by the maintenance practice. Right. I thank you very, very much, and thank you, Mr. Chairman, for the opportunity to pursue this line of questioning, and I will have other questions later. Thank you.
It was very helpful, Mr. Oberstar. Mr. Ewing.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I appreciate the gentleman coming here and the family members coming here and you having this hearing. I don't have specific questions because much of this information we have read and heard before, but I think it's important that this committee stay on top of this issue and on the safety issues involved here, and I just thank all the participants for their participation here today.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Mr. Boswell.
Mr. Chairman, I appreciate the explanation of vapor and all that you went through. That was extremely well done. The ignition source, and I think that Mr. McSweeney probably answered my question. I've been mulling around this morning a little bit. We've talked about the vapor, the volatility, the static source of energy, and then the question came to my mind as I thought about the tank and the mounting of the fuel pump, and have you eliminated any possibility of an arc? Does that pump stay on? Does it kick on and off? How does it operate in that particular aircraft?
Sir, I'd like to let in the FAA, we recognize the primary responsibility for accident investigation is the NTSB. We support them and try to give them all the knowledge that we can generate in that investigation. However, I always prefer that the NTSB answer questions specific
to an
investigation.
That's fine. I don't care.
Yeah,
There were three fuel pumps that are associated with the center wing tank. There are two scavenge pumps, one scavenge pump and two jettison pumps. The jettison pumps, we have recovered, done tests on them extensively through the party system with the FAA participating, and we see no indication that they were in any way a player in the accident. We have yet to recover and will not recover the scavenge pump. However, to answer the question that you asked directly, the scavenge pump, there would have been no reason for it to be on. We do not have dispositive evidence, but we have very suggestive evidence that it was off. We have not yet eliminated is it a possibility of being the ignition source. However, the evidence seems to suggest that it was not on.
Well, I appreciate you saying that. And early in the flight, the fuel load at that time, I would understand it wouldn't expect it to be on. Tragic accident happened to a neighbor of mine, not in an airplane, but in a car. He, the night before, had picked up some lawnmower gasoline, did not fill the tank full, set in his car, it set overnight, and it vaporized. Frosty morning, he got in the car, and he started down the street and decided to turn on his heater or his defrosters. And of course, the Lark, no protection, and he had a tragic death. And so the thought just occurred to me, if we eliminate any possibility of an arc, and I'm sure you did that early on, and that's what you're doing, and so at least to satisfy my curiosity, I had to bring it up, because that's all it would take to make it go. And if it could happen through a crack in the system, aging or whatever, I don't know, but there's several things that could cause even a well-protected, engineered switch, you know, over a period of time or so on. So I was just concerned to bring that up. Thank you.
Thank you. I want to thank Chairman Duncan for allowing Congressman Barsh and myself to participate in today's hearing. I'm Tilly Fowler from Florida, and thank my two colleagues here for allowing me to jump ahead of them for just a few moments here to get something on the record. Congressman Barsh and I want to express our interest in the issue of airframe wire safety standards. And my question is directed to Associate Administrator Mr. Gardner. However, if Mr. Kellstrom wants to respond, then I'd welcome his comments as well, and I'd just like your response for the record, really. Mr. Gardner, on July the 2nd, the Washington Post cited FAA officials suggesting that chafed wires could have played a role in the TWA crash. And the Post also reported that an inspection of electrical wiring inside early Boeing 747s could have caused future explosions if that had been left undetected. So even if faulty wiring turns out not to be the cause in this instance, it seems that we should be looking to raise our safety standards as it applies to wiring inside these planes. Now, I understand that FAA requirements for airframe wiring have not changed in 20 years, and yet the technology has advanced greatly in the meantime. There are several companies in this country that are producing a new generation of airframe wire that provides superior performance electrically and mechanically, and it's got virtually no flammability and smoke generation characteristics. And my understanding is the Defense Department has recognized and is using this new technology, but the private sector is lagging behind. So for the record, I hope you could answer whether we can expect that the FAA is going to take a more proactive role in moving the industry towards safer wiring, especially in light of the revelations that faulty wiring is a prime suspect in this crash. And if my colleagues would grant unanimous consent for Congressman Barsha to do a follow-up on this, I would appreciate it, and then we would have our answers for the record.
Go ahead, Mr. Barsha.
Thank the chair and, of course, the committee members for their indulgence. I'd just like to echo the sentiment of the gentlelady from Florida, Congresswoman Fowler, and raise some additional concerns with regard to this issue. I first brought the composite wire issue to the attention of the FAA on September 19, 1996, when I asked then Administrator Hinson during a science committee hearing to look into the technological advancements made in airframe wiring in light of the fact that the current regulations of governing airframe wiring were written more than 20 years ago. On March 13, 1997, I asked the FAA for an update on my original question during a technology subcommittee hearing, to which the FAA replied, and I quote,
The wire industry is providing outstanding products to the airframe manufacturers, including hybrid composite wire insulation constructions. The airframe manufacturers select the best wire type based upon their independent evaluations and installation practices. The FAA believes that with regard to flammability and smoke, the choices that are being made for today's aircraft provide outstanding performance. To assist manufacturers in the selection of the best available fire-safe aircraft wiring, the FAA has developed smoke and arc tracking test methods for incorporation into an upgraded aircraft material fire test handbook, which will be published within the next 6 months. While encouraged by this response, I am nevertheless concerned that an upgraded aircraft material fire test handbook would do little in addressing the safety issues recognized by the McDonnell Douglas and the FAA fire safety section studies, in that such volunteer testing could make accurate wire testing either cost prohibitive or without appropriate supervision would likely increase the possibility of human error. It is my sincere hope that in light of the thoughtful comments made by Congresswoman Fowler, its approval of and incorporation into our nation's military aircraft, and the testimony received today, we can work together in addressing this very important issue.
Thank you very much, Mr. Barsha. And with those statements by Mrs. Fowler and Mr. Barsha, we'll proceed with the questioning by Mr. LaHood.
To all of the panelists, I surely can't appreciate all of the sophisticated information, and but let me just speak, if I can, for the families of the deceased passengers. Mr. Hall or Mr. Kallstrom, either one of you or both of you, if you set aside all of the technology and technical information and vapors and all of this stuff, Mr. Hall, do you, or Mr. Kallstrom, do you think there'll ever be a day when you'll wake up and tell the American people what exactly happened on this flight? Because I think in reality, when you set aside all the scientific information and all the other stuff, the relatives want to know. Will they ever know? Will you ever be able to tell them precisely what happened on this flight?
Congressman, I know Mr. I would like certainly Mr. Kallstrom to comment as well. Let me say that the families of this flight are extremely important in human beings. I am equal concern about the families of U.S. Air Flight 427 and United Airlines Flight 585, both that are other accidents that have occurred that we've had the responsibility to investigate, that we have not been able to come up with a probable cause as of this date. We continue to work on these investigations. As I mentioned to the chairman, we're going to try to find a probable cause because we, I mean, do everything we can, because we know that's the only way that in the minds of the families and many of the American people, this issue will be put to rest. But as Mr. Kallstrom alluded to, it's our responsibility to do this in a professional, thorough, and methodical way so that in the process, we're sure that we're not providing any misinformation or false hope or false answers to the American people that we have to go back and correct. And so this has been a very time-consuming, frustrating, took a long time to get the airplane out of the water and reconstructed. These tests that we're referring to this morning with vapors, and I identify with you, Congressman, I have no technical background, so I just try to follow it the best I can. But all these tests and things are very dangerous in themselves because we're looking at trying to understand how this explosion occurred, and doing this work in laboratories and in flight tests is dangerous in itself. So I certainly hope so, and I think so, and I believe that given all the resources at this Congress, you know, we've spent some $27 million has been appropriated to our agency. We will have spent $30 million by October 1.
and by the support that we've received from this Congress, using all of the best laboratories, facilities, and minds that we can find, that we are going to find out the cause of TWA 800. Mr. Kallstrom.
Mr. Congressman, let me also give you a non-technical answer. Let me give you an emotional answer.
Good.
The investigators, the FBI agents, the police officers, the Coast Guard people, people that brought the bodies ashore, people that were there, people that had the tragedy in their face, the people that related to this professionally and emotionally, everybody wants the answer. We don't know the answer. Please understand, we don't know it, and for some other reason we're not saying it. We don't quite know the answer yet because we're not done with the process. Now, my agency and all the law enforcement agencies that support me are charged with answering the question, was it criminal or wasn't it criminal? And we don't want to rush to judgment on that. We don't have that answer, and we're standing around waiting to have a good time to say it. We're doing everything humanly possible around the clock to make sure in this world we live in today, with the tragedies we've seen before, when this happened that night, we had on trial in the Southern District of New York Ramzi Yosef and other co-conspirators for a plot hatched in the Philippines to blow up 11 wide-body American flag-carrying jumbo jets with very sophisticated, different type of dastardly technology than we had seen before. So the answer is, we couldn't agree with you more. We couldn't agree with the families more. We want that answer ourselves. If this was a criminal act, we don't want the cowards that did it to have one more hour, one more day, one more week, or one more month, obviously. But the significance of standing up and making an opinion on whether this was or wasn't is so, in our view, important that we have to be right. We have to measure 10 times and cut once. So believe me when I tell you. In fact, let me add one other thing. The FBI lost one of their very dear friends in this accident. The wife of an agent in our office, who was one of the senior attendants, we lost on that flight. So understand, please, that we want the answer. And when we say what we think it is, or we think it isn't, you know, we're going to be able to say with a good conscience that we did everything. We did it 10 times. We looked under every rock. You know, we left no stone unturned. We took no day off to get that answer.
So the answer to the question, Mr. Kallstrom, is that you believe that someday you are going to wake up and tell the American people exactly what happened.
Well, I don't know what you mean by wake up, but someday I think the FBI, you know, if by wake up you mean we're asleep and we're going to wake up, I don't agree with that. But if someday we're going to know was it criminal or wasn't it, I believe we will. And the next point is I believe someday we'll know exactly what happened, because I think NTSB has the best science in the world on this. They have a bunch of experiments and tests that are on the flight path. I think we'll know. I think the probability is we will know.
Can either one of you tell us, based on the fact that you have 28 years experience and Mr. Hall, I know you have an enormous amount of experience, generally when do you think that'll be? Is it going to be a year from now, 2 years from now, 5 years from now, a month from now? When is it going to be?
Well, from our standpoint, Congressman, we have a week's hearings planned in the first week or second week of December in Baltimore, Maryland. I have asked Dr. Loeb and Dr. Ellingstad to try to complete as many of these tests as possible, so that when we open the factual record on this investigation, which we will not do, however, until the FBI has made its determination, and Mr. Kallstrom and I have had discussions on this point, I would hope that we could have this completed by the second anniversary of this accident. But, Congressman, I am looking now at the third anniversary of U.S. Air 427 in Pittsburgh coming up this September. And
And as Mr. Kallstrom stated so well earlier, the only thing worse than not waking up and giving the answer would be to wake up and give incorrect information or the wrong answer. And I assure you that won't happen. If we have an answer, everything that we know, you will know, the American people will know, and I pray that we will have the answer.
Mr. Kallstrom, I don't want you to believe that the term that I used, wake up, meant that you'd been sleeping at the switch. Contrary, I don't at all. I respect very much the work that you have done, that all of the agents have done. The fact that you have so many experienced people working on this, I think, gives us assurances that that you will give us the answer. But, and I know you know this, there is a tremendous amount of frustration and emotion built up in the survivors and wanting to know what happened. And I know you know that, and I did not mean the term wake up, that you'd been asleep at the switch by any stretch of my imagination or yours. May I ask Mr. Kallstrom one other question? Sure. I know that you've had under your possession or the possession of the investigation the belongings and the possessions of those who were deceased. Could you give us any idea when those might be released to the family members?
Sir, let me just say, I know you didn't mean that. I just wanted to, for the record, make a point for all the thousands of people that have worked around the clock on this thing. Believe me. As far as the personal effects, we are not holding any of them, the FBI, for evidentiary purposes. They've all been turned over to the vendor.
Congressman, Mr. Peter Goltz, who is in charge of our Government and Family Affairs Office, advises me that all of the associated effects have been returned. Assume, Peter, that means the things that have been identified with a particular individual. The unassociated effects, I think, are being cataloged so that the families can identify what might belong to them, and that process is well underway.
Thank you for your indulgence, Mr.
And if I could just make one more comment, Congressman, while I know there is great interest in the cause of this particular accident, we do feel that we have made recommendations and working with the FAA will make, will be able to prevent a future accident like this. So that work is ongoing as we try to find out exactly what happened here.
Thank you very much, Mr. Hood. Mr. Trafficant has asked to come to him next with a couple of brief questions, and then I'm going to go straight to Mrs. Danner, and I'm going to give Mrs. Danner some extra time because she has a direct representation of many, many TWA employees.
I'd just like the panel, as an old sheriff, to answer my questions, yes or no. If you can't, I want you to say you can't answer it. First question, Mr. Hall. Hypotheses and theory is an opinion, not a fact, correct? Hypotheses is theory, not fact, correct?
Yes.
To this point, is there any physical evidence, conclusive forensic physical evidence, to prove that it was a mechanical failure that caused the explosion of the center fuel tank? Yes or no? I heard a lot
no,
of testimony.
No, but we're looking at that. There are things
no,
that we...
I want a one-question answer. I know this is tough. At this point...
Yeah. No.
No. Okay. Mr. Kallstrom, were there, in fact, traces of PETN and RDX found in that plane wreckage?
There were explosive chemicals found.
Isn't it a fact that PETN and RDX are widely known as components of Semtex?
Yes.
A terrorist substance?
Yes.
Isn't it a fact that plane was underwater for several weeks at least?
Yes.
Other than the theory of the dog having placed these rudiments of such chemicals on the plane, is there any other evidence of any kind that would support in any way the chemicals getting on that plane?
There's other remote possibilities, yes.
Basically, they're very remote, would you say?
Yes.
Okay. Let me ask you this. Is there any evidence that documents that this wide-bodied 747 was, in fact, visited by a dog at St. Louis?
Yes.
Do you have a general gate number, or do you know for sure that the dog was on that plane?
We know for sure. Well, we have the report of the St. Louis Air Force Police that document the training. Very specifically document the training, document the packages that were put on, document the condition of the packages.
My question, not to interrupt you, was it conclusive that a dog was on this plane that blew up?
Yes.
Okay, fine. Now, Mr. Kallstrom, we have the presence of PETN RDX. We now know the manner in which the plane had broken apart. The flight data recorder contained no hint of a mechanical malfunction. With that background, isn't it a fact that the potential of a terrorist act is very prominent here?
Absolutely, and that's why we've done what we've done and why we're continuing to do what we're doing.
Now, for the FAA, isn't it a fact that you issued your own analysis of this crash? Yes or no?
We issued an analysis.
An analysis. Isn't it a fact that your findings differ from the NTSB's official report?
No, sir.
It is not?
No, sir.
Is it a fact that you're resisting the recommendations of the NTSB?
No, sir.
Relative to aircraft design and operational changes?
No, sir.
It is not? I'd just like to say one thing in closing. It didn't take a long time. As a former sheriff, something does stink. When you find the precursors of evidence of chemicals that are widely known in terrorist activities, that plane in St. Louis, there should be conclusive evidence to show that that dog was there. And I have one last question for Mr. Kallstrom. Isn't it a fact that where that dog was to have visited those aircraft, that is not the part of this plane where the precursors of Semtex were found?
That's not true. And if I could just add for your information, it's very important where the packages were put, Congressman. And the test packages that we looked at and that were in very bad condition, that unfortunately were dripping those chemicals, were placed exactly above the location in the airplane where we found the chemicals on the floor. Now, that isn't 100% that that's where they came from, but that's exactly where it was.
One last question. From the visit from this canine, would the residue of these chemicals still remain, having been underwater for several weeks in a saltwater environment? They would still have remained, and they would have had enough potency as placed from that dog to have withstood the rigors of that environment that would break down such chemicals.
Well, we think so. And the place we found the chemicals were on the two-sided tape that actually holds the floor panel, the carpet panels in the plane. And the scientists tell me, NTSB scientists would agree, and of course, understand we found very, very minute traces. The scientists tell me that would be the only place on the plane, the absorbent sticky material, where those types of chemicals could survive. And the other comment I'd make is that an incredible amount of this chemical leaking out of these packages fell into that spot.
Mr. Kallstrom, let me just say one last thing. There's nobody that has better science, forensic evidence, dealing with criminal activity than the FBI. And the point that I would like to make is, and one last question of you, yes or no, have you determined with absolute forensic proof a mechanical failure and a mechanical condition that produced this explosion?
Absolutely not.
No further questions. Thank you, Chairman.
Thank you, Mr. Trafficant. Mrs. Dander, do you want to go ahead and start, or you want to wait till you come back?
All right, we'll break then for this vote, and we'll start with Mrs. Danner when we come back. Thank you very much.
Where are the lights?
Hearing back to order, please, and we'll proceed now with the
Questions by Mrs. Danner.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. First of all, before I move into the questions that I have of the panel, I would like to follow up on my colleague's question regarding the drug-sniffing dogs and the plane when it was in St. Louis, as I understand it. Both Congressman Traficant and I would like sent to our offices immediately the documentation that shows the plane number, not just the gate where it was or was not located, but the plane number. And we do have that, I assume.
I don't have it with me, but I'd be happy to furnish any documentation we have.
And it does indicate the plane's number as well as the fact that it was just located at a certain gate.
Well, my information is that it was the exact plane. What series of numbers or identifiers were specifically used to reach that determination? I don't personally know, but my information is it was exactly. Of course, that was key to us. I mean, it would be nonsensical for us to be involved in the wrong plane.
Rather like any piece of equipment that has a serial number, so a plane is notified and
has
a number attached.
But I'll be happy to furnish you with the documentation that convinced us it was the exact plane.
Thank you. I would appreciate that. When there is a murder or when there is an automobile accident, one of the first things that the investigators ask for are eyewitnesses. Are there any eyewitnesses? I was pleased to hear you, Mr. Kallstrom, say that you all have interviewed, and I assume have interviewed, all of the people who purport to be eyewitnesses immediately after or soon thereafter after the accident.
Yes, ma'am. Just to give you some idea of that, 48 hours after this tremendous tragedy, we had up close to 700 of our agents doing interviews.
And how much emphasis do you place on eyewitness reports?
Well, you know, we took the I made reference to the fact that we talked about a missile from almost the beginning of this tragedy. I mean, I wasn't even back to the office yet when we had information through FAA of air crews that were reporting things in the sky. No one ever said a missile, none of the witnesses. But by that morning, after the tragedy, we had upwards of 100 people on their decks, golf courses, driving, whatever they were doing out there in different places, in boats, standing on bridges, that described to us events in the sky, which we took very, very seriously. And we had a missile theory. We talked about it at the first press conference or the second press conference. We said there's a possibility a missile shot down this plane. I think it's the first time anyone's ever said that in the United States. And of course, that theory had two legs. Friendly fire, not because we thought that that was the case, but if a missile went up there, where would it have come from? Well, friendly fire or terrorists. So those were the two legs of the theory. And we interviewed and ended up with over 200 witnesses to these events in the sky from many, many different locations.
And you've interviewed all of them?
We've interviewed all of them, most of them more than once, some as many as 3 and 4 times. Yes.
Then I need to switch my questioning over to Mr. Hall, because according to the Associated Press, and obviously as an elected official, I know that the newspaper accounts are not always terribly accurate. I must make that statement. But the Associated Press quotes one of your staff as saying the NTSB does not place undue weight on eyewitness accounts. What does that mean?
Well, I do not know which investigator made that comment, Congresswoman, but we generally, obviously, eyewitness information can be valuable. We have found through 30 years of investigative history, and our professional investigators tell me that obviously many times there can be conflicts between people that have seen the same event, and because of the shortness of the event or whatever, the excitement of the moment, the information can be incorrect. So we place more evidence on the physical, more emphasis on the physical evidence that is available from the accident, but we certainly don't discount the eyewitnesses.
There are press reports that investigators believe mechanical failure is the most likely cause of this accident. Is that accurate information?
Well, Congressman, we are, as I said earlier, we are looking still at six scenarios. One of those scenarios involves the possibility of a small charge being on the tank or a high-velocity fragment, which could be either space junk or breakup of a missile penetrating the tank. We have no evidence at this point, but we continue to look in that area.
Once again, quoting not this time the AP, but an article in actually this morning's paper, investigators have ruled out a large bomb, but say a small shaped charge, and I would ask you all to expound on that phrase later, could have been placed near the rear wall of the center tank. A shaped charge is a small amount of explosive that could have punched a hole in the center tank and not leave the typical telltale signs of big bombs. Small pieces from the rear wall, which is accessible from the ground, are still missing. Is that correct?
No.
Well, I would agree with...
Excuse me, Mr. Kallstrom. First of all, the physical evidence, then we'll get into the bomb. Okay. Is that part of the plane still missing?
Yes, I would like to have Dr. Ellingstad, if I could, comment on that.
We have recovered to date a very large proportion of the center fuel tank. We have no evidence from the wreckage that has been recovered with respect to that data, any indications of that kind of penetration. We're certainly still looking at that with respect to the reconstruction that we have done, with respect to documenting and cataloging every shred of metal that we have come up with.
Now, is there a piece of the rear wall missing that would be large enough to have contained the explosive area?
We'll let Dr. Loeb comment on that.
The answer to your question is yes, but there are areas within the center tank in that we do not have material. Material is missing. Material that is large enough to perhaps have something penetrated it—a small charge, a fragment of space debris coming in, a missile warhead that fragmented—and so we are embarked upon trying to determine whether we can rule that out conclusively. We have tests that are going on, as were referred to earlier in the testimony in Bruntingthorpe, England. The FBI is participating in those tests with us. They are specifically to look at the manifestations that would remain if you had a small shape charge go off on the tank. We are going to place those charges in a number of different positions on the tank, five probably to be specific, in the rear, on the spar, on the beam that is just behind the forward spar, on the top, on the bottom, specifically where access to the tank could be had from someone relatively easily. One of the things that the majority of the material that is missing is on the left side body rib. Fortunately for us, there is no possibility that someone could have placed a charge there because the left main inboard wing tank is sitting there full of fuel. So we're looking at that. We're also looking at the fragmented warhead possibility. The FBI has done a lot of work on that. They can talk to you about that. We're looking at it. The answer is yes, and we're going to try to determine whether that was a possibility.
Just to reiterate then, there is a large enough piece missing that could have contained a small fragment that would have ignited the vapors.
That is a possibility.
Yes, ma'am.
Now, Mr. Kallstrom, sorry to have interrupted you, but you can tell me about this.
No, I would just...
We've heard of shaped charge. That's a new phrase for me.
Well, it's just really a little explosive device that would be directional, that would go in one direction. So its energy would be like on a beam as opposed to a 360-degree broadcast. It's just another device. The point I would want to make is, and the reason that we have not said that it wasn't criminal, is we're not done with the investigation. We are, as we speak, crawling all over that plane, the mock-up, with metallurgists, and forensic scientists, to try to figure out any possibility. And I'd take it one step further than what Dr. Loeb just said. We're not just looking where it could be easily put, we're looking where it could be put under any circumstances. Make the assumption they could have access for hours. And that's our job to do that.
so that when we reach a determination, we're not looking to get out of this or make an easy exit or come up with an answer without doing the work. And that's exactly what we're doing.
I just had an impression from what I have heard in committee, from what I have heard from other interested parties, from what I've read and seen through the media, that the FBI was, in a matter of speaking, the terrorist issue was being shunted aside in favor of some other theories, because new theories are constantly coming forward. I think it was just a week or two ago that someone began postulating that this might have started out in one of the wings and come back in. I mean, that was something that it was almost a year before we even heard that postulation. So it looks to me as though people are...
But Congressman, understand this. The FBI's job with the law enforcement team that supports us, our only goal is to answer the question, was it criminal or not? Mm-hmm. So, I mean, NTSB and other people do all kinds of experiments. That doesn't just detract us from what we're doing. I mean, right. We're focused on answering that question. We're not going to answer it until we can say with great certainty that it didn't happen.
I appreciate that, and I am sure that the families appreciate it as well. I'm reading also something, Mr. Gardner, that you said. There are several accidents on the records now where we could not definitely determine the cause, but more resources have been applied to finding a cause for this accident than any other aviation accident in history. And there's a very tough decision of when do you admit you're not going to find the cause. Now, because Mr. Hall said that this is the third anniversary of Flight 427, do we assume that this is going to go on 3, 4, 5 years, perhaps? Anyone may answer the question, but I was quoting your statement.
Well, since it was my quote, let me make a comment and then turn it over to Chairman Hall. That statement based on my understanding of what Chairman Hall thinks. I mean, he has the responsibility of deciding how long to investigate an accident and what resources to apply to it to find the cause. And my comment about that is a tough decision, and I believe I'm speaking for the board. I'm not speaking for the board. Excuse me. I think the Chairman Hall would agree with me. That's an incredibly tough decision, and when you have exhausted all possibilities of investigating accidents. Let me say that I've flown for most of my career as a pilot in the Air Force and NASA, and I have flown all kinds of aircraft vehicles, and I have lost a good number of friends in aircraft accidents. Most of those accidents we have found the solution to. Some we have not, and those are very difficult.
Thank you. Mr. Hall, when does one determine how to terminate an investigation?
Well, I certainly think once you've exhausted every possibility, and we're certainly a long way from that on this investigation.
A long way. Tell me, what is the lengthiest investigation you have going on? Is it Flight 427?
Yes, ma'am. I would have to refer to some of my colleagues or the professional staff with the board, but I think it is the longest investigation that's remained open at the board.
Mr. Chairman, considering my colleagues, I will pose the rest of my questions, and I have a number of them, in written form to the three different entities that are present here today, and would ask that you get back to me in an expeditious manner with your responses. I'd appreciate that very much. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, Ms. Danner. Mr. Oberstar, we'll come back to you.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. We've had this panel here for quite some time, and I know there are other witnesses that we want to hear from. Mr. Kallstrom, I would hope that the FBI move expeditiously, accelerate its expeditious action, let us say, to conclude its aspect of this case, because it seems to have an inhibiting factor upon the other roles of the other two agencies. And I can't make a judgment for you. I can't tell you how to do that. I can only say that in some way there is both the perception and the reality of slowdown on the other part, certainly of FAA, of the criminal aspect.
Well, let me say, Mr. Congressman, that we are moving as quickly as we can. We're being as thorough as we can. We've reassigned countless assets from other major investigations to work
that.
On this.
I understand.
I have absolutely no knowledge. Your comment about we're slowing down NTSB or FAA is the first time I've ever heard that. I can't think of anything that we do that would in any way slow down anybody. I mean, we're providing tremendous support to this investigation. The security of all the materials, the Calverton hangar, communications, all kinds of things. I mean, if you know, if your recommendation is for the FBI to leave before we've done our investigation.
I didn't say that. You know that.
But I cannot think of anything that we do or anything that we put in place that maybe Mr. Hall would comment on that.
Congressman, I think, as I've indicated throughout the testimony, we've worked together side by side in a very cooperative fashion. Obviously, with a criminal investigation, there are certain, what's the word on evidence? Rails of evidence and handling of evidence that have been followed. I don't think in any way the only thing that we would not be in a position to do until the FBI does complete its investigation is have a public hearing and open our public record. But I don't think in any other way that would the joint participation would have an impact on our investigation.
You will withhold public hearing until after the FBI has concluded its phase of this work?
That would be our preference, yes, sir.
In the aftermath of the Aloha 737 tragedy, which resulted or which produced a catastrophic hull failure, unprecedented, the FAA moved expeditiously without delay to call a worldwide conference on aging aircraft. I addressed the opening session of that conference. This committee moved in the aftermath to enact legislation, put a legislative framework around maintenance of high time aging aircraft. It was the first failure of its kind. Scared the daylights out of aeronautical engineers and of airframe maintenance personnel and of airline operators. And no effort and expense was spared to address the issue of aging aircraft from one incident. It seems to me with 26 incidents that there is a cause here to call the same kind of worldwide conference on center fuel tank experience and bring together the best minds from all other aviation entities in a conference with a very tight time frame and with a very clearly focused objective to not proceed through the time-consuming, very difficult federal rulemaking procedure and highlight this issue and try to bring it to closure as was done with the aging aircraft issue. In the aftermath of the aging aircraft conference, there have been three subsequent conferences on the same subject, monitor the progress, and I suggest the same be done in this case. And I'd like your response, Mr. Gardner. At least to the extent of saying you'll discuss it with the administrator, the secretary, and recommend that it moves ahead.
Yes, sir. I see that as a great idea to follow on to the extensive comments that we have asked for. And we have really activated the entire world to help us address this issue. And I will certainly proceed with that idea. I think it's a great idea.
Final observation is, with great respect again for the NTSB, the enormous contribution they made, not only in this case, but in all other cases of aviation safety. And you know the repeated expression of respect I have for the NTSB. Its reputation and its credibility rests upon its dispassionate, objective, reasoned, scientifically sound, and meticulous analysis of accident data at the accident site and in the laboratories, not in the TV studios, not with the somewhat alarmist rhetoric with which Mr. Loeb discussed this subject recently in a television interview. In an area, in an era and an arena of finites, it is inappropriate to talk of absolutes. And I understand ideas and words can escape in the course of an interview. But to say it absolutely could happen, that is, vapor buildup, accident again, to say it absolutely could happen is alarmist in my judgment. And it's uncharacteristic of the NTSB. Work together. Continue the course that the NTSB has set. Very high standard. Basing actions, judgments, recommendations on scientific, factual evidence. Be the prod and the goad that you are supposed to be to the department and to the modal administrations. Don't engage in this kind of activity. It's a disservice to the NTSB. Thank you again for
what
you do.
Thank you, Congressman.
Standard, do you have an additional comment?
I would just like to associate myself with my colleague, Jim Oberstar's remark. He has expounded on what I alluded to in my earlier remarks, and I believe him to be absolutely correct in what he says. I would suggest to you, Mr. Hall, that you determine who is going to be the spokesman for your department and see that they speak for the department and not for their own personal self-aggrandizement. Thank you.
Well, thank you, Congressman. Let me, if I could, briefly respond on both of those points. We are a very small agency. There are 360 people, and we're very grateful for the appropriated funds that you provide us. But we do not invest a lot of money in a public affairs office. We have, however, some very able and capable people that in that office. We have our agency was responsible for having to respond on a responsible manner on inquiries for the number of what was so-called the number one and number five news stories of 1996, something I still find unbelievable considering it was a presidential election year. We get into a situation where each and every network, each and every newspaper is competing for information. We are a public agency. You've heard a lot of talk about cover-up. Mr. Kallstrom and I constantly have to deal with, you know, what are you hiding and what are you doing? And let me just tell you, Congresswoman, it's kind of hard to hold your temper when people are challenging your integrity. I'm very proud of my public service, and I know Mr. Kallstrom and everyone at this table is. Now, I made the decision to put Dr. Loeb on television because Dr. Loeb has a very able technical background, and I am sure that Dr. Loeb and I both wish maybe we'd been in the cutting room with Mr. Sam Donaldson when he decided what he put on the air. But those mistakes are made. We apologize for them. We're doing the very best we can. We'll try to keep that from to the very minimum in the future. I've never had a problem with admitting a mistake or taking criticism. I think that criticism's valid. It's to the point. I would say that the only thing I'd say about Dr. Loeb is he isn't the only guilty party. The chairman is not a very good talking head himself. And sometimes when you get on TV and they ask you these questions and you do your best to answer and you say, oh my gosh, I shouldn't have said those two or three words. And I know I have a license to be irresponsible in this job, and all I can tell you is that every time that I open my mouth publicly on behalf of the agency, I'm going to try and be responsible.
And if you feel that I'm not, please, as you have done here, bring it to our attention. We'll try to correct it and do better.
We appreciate that very much, and we will hold you to the adjective you used, responsible response. Thank you.
I do think, Mr. Hall, a number of members on the committee do feel strongly on this issue, and I'm sure along with them appreciate your response to it today. Before I go to Mr. Cook, Mr. Kallstrom, would you just give us, to pursue another area for just a second, would you give us some information on how many witnesses on the ground or in other airplanes at the time believed they saw something coming from the ground headed toward that plane, and what you've done to pursue that?
Well, I wouldn't want to say that they all saw something coming from the ground. There were about 200 people that saw events in the sky that they described, none of which described a missile. A number of those did describe events they thought were ascending. It breaks into different categories, though, of what they actually describe. About 200 people altogether.
How many of them would you say saw approximately the same thing?
A good bulk of the people on the shore report, and we triangulate, that they're describing roughly the same event. You know, so let's say 60 or 70.
And you've talked to all 200 of those people?
We've talked to all of them, most on multiple occasions, some three or four times. Yes, sir.
Okay. Mr. Cook.
Yes, first of all, Mr. Kallstrom, I'd just like to follow up on some of the questioning of my colleague from Ohio, Mr. Traficant. I really didn't hear you say that the chemical substance that he was referring to was in fact RDX or PETM, but let's just assume it was. Let's just assume that's the material.
It was.
It was the material. does that, the idea that there are residues of that, does that make the terrorist theory or the idea that a PETN or an RDX bomb that certainly is used a lot by terrorists and is certainly a bomb that would be capable of doing what happened to Flight 800 happen, but finding a residue like that, is that really consistent with an RDX bomb going off? Or aren't there
lots of... Yes, I think finding residue is consistent, but it does not get you to the critical mass of making a determination that it was a device. It certainly points you in the direction.
Well, of course it does, but if I could just talk for a minute about two types of explosives. As a manufacturer of explosives, we take solids and liquids and through slurry or emulsification processes make what you were referring to, Mr. Gardner, as an oxygen-balanced explosive. Now, those also occur naturally. They certainly occur probably a lot more often than we would like to admit, even in any kind of fuel container, whether it's somebody's gas can at home or a jet tank. There are, whenever you have the vaporizations, you have some natural explosive mixtures once you turn them into gases. If it's oxygen balanced, and there's no reason to assume that somewhere on the scale it can't become oxygen balanced, and it's common. It's got to be common, in my opinion, in fuel tanks that have very little fuel in them, to have these mixtures occur a lot. I guess what I'm really driving at is, given evidence of the fuel level in the center tank and the likelihood of these vapors and these oxygen-balanced mixtures that have got to occur hundreds of times every day in airlines, and I still fly them. And given the residue, isn't it likely, and the fact that, to me, if an RDX or PTN bomb is going off, we're really not going to see a lot of traces of that RDX. When it detonates, it pretty much consumes, unless there have been some drippings, I guess, before from a.
Well, I think that's the very reason why when we first discovered, when the laboratory forensic scientists discovered the traces on the absorbent material, and the other materials we had around there were devoid of the typical signs you'd see of a device, you know, we knew clearly that this didn't, it was a pointer, but we needed the forensic, the metal. We needed the other evidence. When we found out specifically the testing that took place in St. Louis with the police officer, and he was interviewed, and he described where he put the dummy, not dummy, but real packages, and we examined that, and we saw that they were very old, and in particular the one that was in the general vicinity, right above where we found these traces, was leaking those chemicals. I think the pointer then was not necessarily in the direction of a device, void of any other collateral information. And I can tell you, we're looking for that collateral information. That's what we're looking for.
If I could just have the liberty to finish off this, I would just like the opinions of Mr. Gardner, Mr. Hall, and Mr. Hallstrom on the assumption explosion occurred. Now, I know that hasn't been even finally determined, but under that assumption, can't you at least give us an opinion as to whether it's most likely from those vapors through possibly faulty wiring, which FAA investigations of other 747s of that age show that those do occur. There are chafed and scratched wires, an obvious ignition source. And it would cause an explosion if a wire somehow, if there were any kind of ignition source, it would bring temperatures of those mixtures that get that way. That's going to explode by nature. It's like the law of gravity. It's going to happen. But I would just, and this obviously points to mechanical failure. I really think that this committee would appreciate your opinion, if you can express one at all, as to whether it's most likely an explosion from mechanical failure or an RDX, PETN type of terrorist or missile or explosion. I mean, you must have a sense of that based on everything you've seen. And I think it'd be useful for us to understand whether, and I know you can't be definitive, but my prediction is, and this is an unfortunate thing to say, but I don't think we'll ever for sure know the cause, because I happen to think it is mechanical, and I happen to think if it was a wire, you'll never know that for sure, 100%, but you might eliminate so many other possibilities, it'll be about 99% on your scales, but I would still appreciate your opinion at this point.
Yes, sir, and I'm going to apologize ahead of time because I'm going to let Chairman Hall answer about speculating on the probability of one scenario from another. To support that, I think what he'll probably say, let me just mention that back in previous careers, I have chaired accident investigations and I have supported accident investigations. And the way I believe they should be done, and I believe the way that the board carries out their investigations, is first you try to develop all the possible scenarios, and you do that and investigate them all before you make any kind of judgment of which is the most likely. Because if you do that, you could well fall into a trap of focusing all your efforts on the wrong possible, on what turns out to be not the correct one. And so a good accident investigation, in my opinion, does not speculate on which one is more probable than another, but looks at them all, tries to eliminate all of them except one in order to determine exact cause was.
And but I'll Mr. Gardner, even after as much time has gone past as has gone past since this tragedy, I mean, I think you're right, obviously. I wouldn't argue with that. It's
right.
Very sensible, but there's been a lot of time, and don't you have to start going down a path?
Let me also point out that whether or not I have a personal opinion, which I actually try to not have, my official position with the FAA is we do not speculate on probabilities of causes. I firmly believe that the right answer is, and as we operate, that's the NTSB's responsibility.
Imagine you're all going to say the same thing.
Yeah.
Well, Congressman, let me, if I could indulge a moment to say the same thing. Basically, we have a process that served the aviation industry and accident investigation for the better part of the century. We have a factual period of the investigation, which is what we're in now. At the time that we complete that, then we will start doing an analysis. I can only reference an investigation that occurred recently up in New Jersey that came to the board, where a train engineer missed a signal. And there was a lot of speculation in the newspaper and everything about fatigue and split schedules, and that was a theory that everyone had, and we followed that very closely. In the process of the investigation, we found out that this particular operator had concealed a medical condition from his employer successfully, and that, in fact, was a result of the accident. So it's until we're in a position to for the staff to make a recommendation to the board on probable cause, we just try the very best we can not to speculate. I can't say that sometimes the media, you'll say something and you can't control exactly how everything's written, but that's how we try to operate.
Mr. Carlson, before you answer, I just want to, I remember well a couple months ago a hearing with this committee where you were very, very persuasive in terms of no chance of any naval assets, I think was the expression used at those times, or friendly, mistakable reasons, but you certainly left open the terrorist questions, and that's still open in your mind, I'm sure. But really, haven't we gone quite a ways in terms of the fuselage and just the nature of some major piercing or explosive? Because quite honestly, to me, in the explosives business, a bit of residue, even of a very, very high explosive like RDX, and a very sensitive explosive like PETN or RDX, isn't very persuasive. If there's nothing else in terms of the hole or the...
Well, it didn't persuade us either. That's
yeah,
why we didn't.
So what I'm saying is, can't you be a little more definitive than maybe Mr. Hall or Mr. Gardner?
I can just tell you this. I mean, that we have found no evidence that convinces us or even begins to convince us it was a criminal act. We've said that publicly on many occasions. But we're not done with the process that we want to complete. We have a bunch of fresh eyes up there now. We're looking at the same holes we've looked at 5 times or 10 times before, but we're looking at them in 3 dimension now because the mock-up was completed a number of months ago. We didn't have the benefit of the mock-up. And I think the prudent thing for us to do in law enforcement is to let that process run, get it done as quickly as possible. I couldn't agree more than Congressman Oberstar, and bring the best people. But we don't, you know, we're just being super careful not to avoid missing something.
I, for one, very much, all of us very much appreciate that, but I, for one, appreciate your statement because I think that there was a feeling after Mr. Trafficant's questioning that it was likely a terrorist action, and that's simply not the case, and I'd just like to make sure that...
We have no evidence of that.
Right.
Ms. McDonald.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and first I would like to thank the family members for their indulgence for being here all morning, as we have tried to grapple with this issue ourselves as members of this committee. Mr. Hall, I will question you on your comments in your presentation. One is the explosion that ignited the fuel vapor in the center tank. Is there not a type of burn, a residue that we can concern perhaps what really took place in terms of this accident? Is there anything that we can glean from that as to why this plane exploded?
No, ma'am. But I can ask Dr. Loeb if he would, if he wants to elaborate on that.
Please.
No.
The explosion.
Well, let me. I would like, if I could, Mr. Chairman, before Congresswoman Danner leaves, if I could just clarify one thing on behalf of our staff. Yes, Congresswoman, I had not picked up in the dialogue that you and I had that the reference that you made in your earlier remark to self-aggrandizement was directed at Dr. Loeb. And I would like to set the record straight. I don't believe that Dr. Loeb has spent 25 years in public service. He is a civil servant, not a political appointee. I made the decision for him to be on TV
because I thought it was important that the American people get the very best information we had about the investigation as we proceed. And none of my association with Dr. Loeb has ever led me to any opinion, and I hope you would not share the opinion, that anything that he did was self-aggrandizement. He did what I asked him to do as a public servant to keep the American people informed. I do regret that, I take Congressman Oberstar's criticism at heart, and we accept that, and we'll try to do better. But I think the feeling was left with my staff that that this is a matter that I needed to set correct, and I wanted to be sure I did that. I apologize for not having picked that up at the time.
You just said that he did what you instructed him to do. You have just said that to me.
I requested him to appear on in the program and provide information. Yes, ma'am.
I would suggest that most people who deal with the media know that sensationalism generally is what leads in any news program. Mm-hmm. And I would suggest that you and those who speak for you keep that in mind in future conversations they have with members of the press.
I appreciate that and understand that. The only thing I wanted to correct was the self-aggrandizement statement.
Well, you know, in Washington, each person has their own opinion. I just heard a colleague say that he virtually is assured in his own mind that it's a mechanical failure, and I certainly don't agree with that either. So we don't always agree on things, do we, here in Washington or anywhere else?
No, ma'am, but the nice thing about America is everybody gets their opinion, and I appreciate you letting me express mine.
Certainly, you're right.
All right, Ms. McDonald, I'm sorry for that interruption. Go ahead with your question.
Thank you. Dr. Loeb, will you respond to the question again of the explosion that ignited this fuel vapor in the center tank? Would perhaps a burn from this explosion or residue give you some indication of why we had this accident?
Unfortunately, the physical evidence, including the evidence of sooting, the evidence of fire, and so forth, does not help us beyond the notion that we had an explosion in the tank. It does not, unfortunately, provide us with the keys to determining where the ignition took place, and therefore perhaps aiding us in determining what ignited the vapors. The very act of the explosion destroys so much of the evidence, of the physical evidence, that it makes it very difficult, and it unfortunately just does not lead, it's not like a road map where it leads us to any particular place. And as a result, what we have to do is back into it, and that is do a lot of tests and see if we can back into the situation. It just doesn't leave the physical evidence that says it was static electricity or that it was the pump. At least we have none now.
If I might add, Congresswoman.
Yes.
The factual record in the investigation establishes that there was an explosion in the center tank. Mm-hmm. The issue that we're trying to deal with in a number of different ways is the specific thing that ignited the vapors in the tank. We have evidence that shows that that's the case. We're working on that on a number of different fronts. On the one hand, we're dealing specifically with these issues, the scenarios that the chairman has mentioned, the static electricity, mm-hmm. the electrical appliances in the pump, and this kind of thing. On the other hand, we're also conducting a variety of test operations that involve the flight test that we're doing up in New York, that involves computer modeling, that involves scale explosion tests that are planned for the next couple of months. And through that testing, we hope to work that problem backwards as well to try to discover, if we can, where in this complex center tank the explosion may have happened. By working this problem from both directions, looking for potential things that could have provided the spark or the energy to ignite it, and then trying to understand the nature of the explosion dynamics to identify where that might have happened. We hope that we can converge and try to answer that, but we're not ruling any specific ignition source out. We're considering all of the half a dozen things that the chairman mentioned. We're open to other things as well.
Mm-hmm. I do recognize the complexity of this problem, but it just seems to me, as I try to grapple myself, that there could be some microscopic residue or something that we could glean as to the explosion. The other question is, are we to conclude that the Mr. Hall, that the characteristics of this fuel air vapor in the fuel tank is something that is unlike you have ever had or dealt with before?
Mr. Dr. Loeb, the Congresswoman wanted to know if this was unlike any vapor we had
characteristics and composition of
characteristics
this
we had seen before. I believe the answer is no, but I wanted to be sure I was technically correct on that. No, ma'am.
You have not seen anything like this before, am I correct?
No.
Just the opposite. No, the characteristics are in fact similar. They are not dissimilar. They're similar to, for example, the explosion in the center tank of the 737 in the Philippines.
There are some similarities.
There are similarities. Yes, there are definitely similarities, and in fact, that's one of the things that led us early on to believe that this was a possibility.
Mr. Kallstrom, is there ever a statute of limitation, be it lives or lost, that we will conclude an answer is we really don't know, we really don't have the answers, so that the families can be at peace? Is there ever a time? I mean, I've heard Mr. Hall say we're still looking into other flights that were that he's dealing with to try to come to conclusions as to why we had those accidents. Is there ever a conclusion that we have to come to and say we really don't know?
Well, I think we're on a track to answer the question, was it criminal or not? We're not quite at the end of that process yet. We're optimistic we can answer that question in the next 60 to 90 days. We hope we can. Now, that's our mission, and we very much want to do that.
Of course.
So I hope that would be the case.
And I hope so for the sake of the family. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Ms. McDonald. We'll have one other questioner here. Mr. Lipinski wants to follow up, and that'll be our last questions of this panel. Mr. Lipinski.
Thank you very much. I happen to believe that it's the center fuel tank and something ignited it, the fumes, and that's what happened. That's my opinion. Since it's a free country and it's Washington, we can all express our opinion. And based upon a lot of things that you gentlemen have said today and a lot of things I've read that you have said, I feel that there's a lot of other people who feel the same way that I do. In light of that, I ask a question. The only time we use the center fuel tank, really, if we're going to fly from this country to the Far East. We don't even use it to fly. No, you're shaking your head, Doctor. Where else do we use it to fly to?
The returning westbound flights out of Athens carry fuel in the center wing tank.
What if we flew from Athens to Shannon and refueled the... Do we do that it without
be,
it then?
That would be a possibility.
Okay. Well, in light of the fact that, once again, I'll get back to most of the time, the only time we use the center fuel tank is when we're flying to the Far East. Why don't we do one of two things? Pull them out, except for the planes that we're going to use to fly to the Far East immediately, or tell all the air carriers they got to fill them up totally and completely. It would seem to me that that would reduce the chances of this accident reoccurring. And as I say, other than flying to the Far East, those coming out of Greece Athens, they could stop at Shannon and refill the wing tanks. I'd like to have a comment from the FAA, from the National Transportation Safety Board in regard to that suggestion.
Yes, sir. Let me let Tom McSweeney address a little bit, but I believe we also have to put fuel in that tank just to get back from Europe to the United States. I'll let Mr. McSweeney amplify that.
Believe me, I've asked that question of myself and my staff. There's a couple of responses I'd like to make. First, as far as empty the tank, don't use it. We would either have to use some other airplanes on the legs from Europe, or, as you say, have airplanes land in Shannon. The accident that occurred, as tragic as it was, is a very, very remote accident. What we really want to be careful of in trying to, even in the interim, deal with that accident is make sure we don't make things less safe. Making more takeoffs and landings, the most prominent part of the flight when you have a possibility of the accident, to me is not a very good solution. As far as filling up the tank, I would not agree with that at all. Right now, just about every airplane that has a center fuel tank lands with that center fuel tank empty. That's a level of safety. Should there be an accident on the ground, on landing, you do not have fuel underneath the passengers. Landing with a full tank does not, in my mind, make things any safer in the landing and takeoff abort environment. If it was a choice, I would clearly go for the choice of taking the fuel tank, swabbing all the fuel out, and blocking them off. But it does severely impact the system, and I would not like it to result in more takeoffs and landings for the same leg of travel, because that is the point at which you're exposed, you have the highest exposure to a possible accident.
I appreciate that information. I would say then that would not be, my idea is not a solution to the problem, but I would say that I've heard a lot of talk about the center fuel tank being very dangerous on the landing and the takeoff. I wonder if the plane should have ever been designed in the first place then with that center fuel tank, in all honesty. Does the Mr. Hall, do you have anything to say?
Well, of course, Congressman, I think I certainly would see what comment Dr. Loeb and Dr. Ellingstad would have, but I think our recommendations essentially speak on that subject, and we've never suggested that the 747s land with a full center wing tank. We have never said that that's the solution to the problem. We've said that we think it was a prudent thing to do on the interim to lower the probabilities of as rare event as this is occurring while we're trying to find out more information. That we thought that was a reasonable recommendation, and of course it's that recommendation on which we presently are in disagreement.
Well, unfortunately, we've been here an awful long time. I have a lot of questions which I'm going to give to various individuals on this panel that I would want answered, but I'm just going to conclude. I understand that the FAA office in Seattle has a theory about a spark starting in one of the wing tanks, and that's what ignited the flames in the ignited the fumes in the center fuel tank. I assume, Mr. Gardner, you're aware of that theory?
Yes, sir, and so is the board. That is one of the theories that Chairman Hall mentioned, one of the scenarios that they're looking at in his opening statements.
Okay. It seems to me that based upon the information I have about that, that's a very real possibility because of some time factors that are in there, and I'm sure that you will all pursue that very vigorously. Gentlemen, thank you very much for your testimony. I certainly appreciate it.
We are grateful to the panel. We're eager to move on to the family panel. I think family members and others here can see that the committee is very interested. We've had a number of briefings. This is the first public hearing we've had on this issue, and we're grateful for the time we've taken from all of you today. And we'll apologize before we start to our family panel that we're later than we thought we'd be in getting you up before us and ready for that to happen right now.
What time did they expect to be talking about noon? Have they generally been here all day?
Husband of Pam Lichner and the father of Shannon and Katie, who were on the flight after Mr. Lichner, Frank Carven, whose brother, who is the brother of Paula Carven and the uncle of Jay Carven, who were on TWA 800, and then Miss Cynthia Cox, the mother of Monica Cox from Montoursville, Pennsylvania, William Rogers Jr., also from Montoursville, the father of Kimberly Rogers, and Hans Ephraimson-Abt from Ridgewood, New Jersey, who's the father of Allison, who was on the Korean Airline flight. We're pleased that you're here. We certainly are sympathetic to all your family's gone through. I know even more than us, you'd like to achieve closure as much as possible, though we also realize that it will never be possible for this to not be part of your lives, and it's helpful that you could take your time to share with us today. Mr. Lichner, do you want to start?
Yes, thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Chairman, members of the committee, my name is Joe Lichner from Houston, Texas. And 1 year ago today, on July 10th, I was the luckiest man in the world. I had a great home, a loving family, including my beautiful wife, Pam, who is 37, my daughter, Shannon, who was 10, my daughter, Katie, who was 8. We had it all. I had recently started a new position with my company, and that's why I was not with my family when they boarded TWA Flight 800 for a short stay in Paris. 1 year ago, on July 17th, 1 week from today, a combination of an original design deficiency in the Boeing 747 center fuel tank and the age of the 25-year-old TWA aircraft killed my entire family. I must apologize in advance to the other family members here who are here today, but I feel that I must describe to you my nightmare so that you can, just for 5 minutes, walk in my shoes. My life was cast into a living hell that will last until the day I die. My entire family, everyone I loved, everyone that loved me, everyone I depended upon, everyone I trusted, gone. Not in an instant, but in a terrifying, mutilating 2.5 minutes that I will replay in my mind every waking and sleeping moment for the rest of my life. Imagine this. Imagine your family sitting in row 43 on the right rear section of the 747. Your 8-year-old daughter sitting next to the window right next to your wife. As they take off, your daughter is so excited to be going on her first international flight. Your older daughter is sitting across the row in the middle section by herself. As they take off, there's a sense of relief. because the air-conditioned units are finally starting to cool the cabin. Then it happens. A loud bang that at first seems so unreal and so out of place. But in an instant, your wife knows that something is very wrong. She reaches for your 8-year-old daughter and holds her tight. She turns to reach for your 10-year-old daughter, but she's too far away. But she sees the fear in her daughter's eyes, but there's nothing she can do about it. The initial explosion was big, but not big enough to kill your family instantly. They're sitting too far back in the plane. Now everyone is screaming. For 30 seconds, the plane holds together. There's hope in their minds that they may be able to make it back to JFK, or at the very least, make a water landing. Then the plane that's going almost 400 miles an hour starts to fall apart. The front part of the plane falls off, and the cold night air rushes down the interior. Everything in the plane becomes airborne. The majority of the plane keeps flying, and your family is now terrified beyond belief. Your 10-year-old daughter is trying to get low in her seat to protect herself. Your wife is clutching your 8-year-old as she turns to see your 10-year-old daughter hit by a piece of airborne luggage traveling at 400 miles an hour. Mercifully, your 10-year-old is now dead. Then the plane starts to rapidly fall apart. The sides of the plane disappear, and your wife and 8-year-old daughter, still alive and strapped in their seats, are thrown from the plane. Now they are free-falling, but still holding on to each other. For 2 minutes they fall, knowing that they're going to die. When they hit the water, their ordeal is finally over, but mine is just beginning. After their bodies are recovered, you swear that you will find the people who did this to your family and bring them to justice. Now imagine this. A room full of corporate lawyers employed by Boeing, TWA, and their insurance carriers sitting in a room strategizing on how to limit their company's liability for killing 230 people. They happened upon an antiquated law that was written in 1920, known as the Death on the High Seas Act. They believe that they have found a legal loophole which will allow them to make a claim that over half of those 230 people on the plane are worthless. I can assure you that my family was not worthless. It's a moral outrage that Boeing and TWA would attempt to shield themselves from justice by hiding behind a law that everyone, including themselves, will readily admit was not designed to cover international air travel. Boeing and TWA should be ashamed. They should be ashamed of themselves for taking this path. And I think that they are, judging by the fact that they're not here to defend themselves at these hearings. Boeing and TWA and their insurance carriers will come to you and attempt to make you and the world believe that they are open to compromise. They will try to portray themselves as willing to work with Congress to modify the Death on the High Seas Act for future deaths. The key word in my last statement was future. They will try to exclude TWA 800 from these modifications. And I'd like to be perfectly clear, excluding TWA 800 from these modifications to the Death on the High Seas Act is totally unacceptable. After the horror that my family experienced at the hands of Boeing and TWA, it is unfortunate that the only justice that I can achieve is through civil action. Intentional or unintentional, one thing is certain. They are responsible for the deaths of 230 people. The distinction between the plane going down 9 miles offshore rather than 3 miles has no bearing on the value of my family's lives. Please do not let Boeing and TWA elude justice. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Lesner. Mr. Carven.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. My name is Frank Carven from Bel Air, Maryland. I lost my sister Paula and my 9-year-old nephew Jay on TWA Flight 800. My sister Paula was a flight attendant for TWA who was on vacation with my nephew, had served TWA for 18 years. First, I'd like to thank Chairman Duncan for the rapid response and holding a hearing on HR 2005. The families of Flight 800 and KAL certainly appreciate his assistance and that of his staff in such an expeditious hearing on this matter. Also, this hearing would not have been possible without the dedication of Representative McDade and his staff. As noted this morning, Congressman McDade's support for the families of Flight 800 has been unyielding, and he garnered the support of a bipartisanship of approximately 40 members of this body to join as co-sponsors on this bill. We certainly want to thank Congressman Oberstar and Congressman Lipinski for their support in their past and the continued support. On a personal note, I'd like to thank my friend who also happens to be my congressman, Bob Ehrlich. He and his staff have been with me every step of the way. When Flight 800 went down last summer, one of the first phone calls I got was from Bob Ehrlich to offer his condolence and to offer any assistance that he could provide. I'm here today not only as a family member, but also as a director and vice president of the Families of TWA Flight 800 Association. Our association is a nonprofit organization incorporated under the laws of the state of New York. There are a number of directors of our organization here, as well as family members in this room today. Our association was formed in the aftermath of this terrible tragedy, and it was formed to assist family members of Flight 800 in any way possible. The association was also an active participant in supporting last year's Aviation Disaster Family Assistance Act. In fact, Joe Lichner and I serve on the Department of Transportation's task force, which is developing the criteria to implement that act. Our organization strongly supports HR 2005 in its present form, which would amend the harsh inequities of the Death on the High Seas Act of 1920. You have heard, and I am sure you will continue to hear, heart-wrenching stories about the impact this law has on families of victims who have died through no fault of their own in aviation disasters which occur more than 3 miles from the U.S. shore. As you may know, under the provisions of the Death on the High Seas Act, claimants are limited to those individuals who are economically dependent upon the decedent. As a result, unless a person on Flight 800 was a, quote, breadwinner of the family, the airline, and other defendants use this law to bar claims for the loss of life, thereby avoiding any responsibility or accountability. To this date, no one can really explain to me in any rational terms why an individual who perishes in an aviation disaster less than 3 miles from our shore has value, while an individual who perishes 3.1 miles from our shore has no value. The loss to the families in each event is the same. A loved one has died. Artificial lines in the water should have no bearing on the value of a person's life. DOSA has no rational basis to the loss of life from aviation disasters. My limited knowledge of the history of the act is that it was enacted to afford widows and orphans of persons lost at sea some monetary compensation, which is limited to pecuniary damages only, awarded without a jury by a district court sitting as an admiralty court. Now, this may have been a major social step in 1920, but in 1997, it has the exact opposite effect, where it bars persons from compensation for the tragic loss of a loved one. Let me say unequivocally that no amount of money or any form of compensation whatsoever can replace the loss my family has sustained. No amount of compensation will bring back my sister or nephew. Paula was our only sister, my mother's only daughter. She was a focal point of our family. My mother lost her daughter and grandson on Flight 800, and the airlines acknowledged that was a tragedy. Who will tell my mother that according to their position, that their lives had no worth? Just last July, TWA told the families of those who were passengers on Flight 800 that their loved ones had died. This July, TWA is telling those same family members that not only is your loved one gone, but they have no value in the eyes of the law. The airlines and other defendants are, for all intents and purposes, shielded from any liability. No one is responsible and no one is accountable. The situation is unacceptable, unconscionable, and shocks the sense of decent, reasonable, and caring human beings. Individuals recover for loss of a loved one in a car accident. People recover for spilling hot coffee on their laps. Families recover for the loss of a loved one in an aviation disaster, which occurs less than 3 miles from our shores. The victims of TWA Flight 800 seem to have been lost twice, once at sea last July and again in the courts of justice of this great country. Please do not abandon the families in their time of greatest need. 1 week from today will mark the one-year anniversary of this terrible tragedy, and there's still no known cause of the explosion. You cannot bring back the people we lost on that plane. You cannot compensate the families for the emptiness left in their lives as a result of this tragedy. And you cannot bring back to us those that perished on that hot July night, last July 17th, in a ball of flame and jet fuel 9 miles from our coast. What you can do is give the families a level playing field. Give the families a fair and equitable day in court. Give the families a chance to tell their stories about the losses they have suffered and the emotional injuries they have sustained. And it's anything less than what has been set forth in H.R. 2005 would be yet another abandonment of responsibility and accountability. Even today, the defendants are using H.R. 2005 in their brief to the court in New York to bolster the position that DOSA applies to TWA Flight 800 and that the claimants are limited to those who are economically dependent and damages are limited to pecuniary losses only. This is the ultimate irony. On the eve of the anniversary of TWA Flight 800, this body, which represents the people of our great nation, can do more for the families of aviation disasters than have been done for them in the history of aviation. You can do the right thing, you can do it for all the right reasons, and you can do it at the right time. On behalf of the families of Flight 800 and those who have lost their lives in all other aviation disasters, I would urge you to pass H.R. 2005 in its present form. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Carven. Ms. Cox.
Thank you. First, I'd like to thank Congressman Duncan and the committee for hearing the family sides of the issues on H.R. 2005 in such a timely fashion. This bill, introduced by Congressman McDade and 40 co-sponsors, tries to rectify the inequities that the families of aviation disasters face due to an antiquated 1920 law commonly known as the Death on the High Seas Act. This course of action has been recommended not only by the Supreme Court, but by the final report of the White House Commission on Aviation Safety and Security. At the tender age of 6, my son Brian can be reprimanded with just the simple question, what is the rule? He will invariably answer, treat people the way you would like to be treated. With simple application of this philosophy, children quickly learn how to apply equality in almost any situation. My daughter Monica was only 16 at the time she boarded TWA Flight 800, and she made me proud time and again with her application of this philosophy. In elementary school, she was a student teacher for the mentally challenged. She wanted to be a veterinarian back then. The saying goes that kids can be cruel. Well, Monica took her fair share of another child's cruelty when she would stop them from teasing or tormenting someone who was smaller, weaker, physically, or mentally handicapped. By the end of sixth grade, she was happy that she could raise money for the Special Olympics, and she had received the Presidential Academic Fitness Award. She was beaming with pride as she read me the accompanying letter from President Bush, exclaiming that the President himself had declared that the winners were the role models for their next generation. By the time she was in junior high school, it was on to student council, taking the SATs by the age of 12 at the request of Johns Hopkins University. That time, she had plans to become an oral surgeon. In high school, it was on to Project Harmony, a group dedicated to promote harmony amongst diversity. After seeing a show on how plastic surgeons were doing pro bono work in third world countries to correct birth defects in children, she decided that being a reconstructive plastic surgeon would help a greater number of people, including children with birth defects and accident victims. Just months before the flight, Monica had an English assignment in which she was to review a story about parents who had lost their son in a war. Her writing shows an idealism common to youth and an insight that is not. She wrote in part, an entire race trying to destroy each other, parents losing their babies, and they are proud to protect a boundary that has no meaning. She continues later with, when a soldier dies, he's gone forever. Medals and glory cannot soothe a mother's tears. Most young intellectuals are inquisitive by nature, and Monica was no exception. I can say with all certainty that if she were here today, I would be floundering for answers to her questions on how a law such as the Death on the High Seas Act could provide such inequities. I know I could explain to her how the Warsaw Convention provisions are, which state that the plaintiff must prove willful misconduct. I could do this by comparing it to the difference between a manslaughter charge, which compares to the lesser degree of liability imposed on domestic flights, and a second-degree murder charge, which compares to the higher standards imposed on international flights. She would be pleased to know that this particular inequity seems to have been resolved in November of 96 and will not be applied in the future. But how would I explain to her that because she died beyond a boundary, which would have no meaning to her, and if we rise to the higher standards of liability imposed and prove willful misconduct, no one will be held accountable because she had no income? How would I explain to her that if a child had miraculously survived the crash of Flight 800, the survivors would not face the limitations of the Death on the High Seas Act, but the families of those who perished would? How would I explain to Monica that the family of another Pennsylvania child, Natalie Calhoun, who also tragically died at sea only within the 3-mile boundary, didn't have to face the Death on the High Seas Act as a result of a decision upheld by the Supreme Court of the United States? How would I explain that while both children died at sea, one set of parents had access to American tort law and a jury trial, and we won't? As the song verse says, children are the future. Teach them well and let them lead the way. Passage of this legislation will teach the youth of today that they are worthy of equality today, and it will reinforce the value that we as parents try to instill in our children, that each of us is accountable for our actions. I would like to thank the committee for allowing me to testify today, which in turn gave me an opportunity to show a little of who Monica was and who she could have been, because if the Death on the High Seas Act is applied to TWA Flight 800, I won't have the opportunity to do so in a court of law. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Cox. We have to go cast a vote right now, and we may start up pretty quickly if we'll start back when either Chairman Duncan or I return, and so that will be within the next 5 to 10 minutes. So thank you all.
Prolong your agony. Prolong your agony. I was trying my damnedest to get it in there in her own handwriting. And my fax was
shooting.
You ought to read the whole thing. There's some portions that I cannot put in there. Dying for the words of women.
Oh, I see.
We're going to go ahead and proceed once again with the hearing, and I want to apologize to the family members who have testified so far. I'm very sorry that I had another meeting which I had to attend, but we will proceed now with the family forum, and we're down now to Mr. William S. Rogers. And Mr. Rogers, you may begin your testimony, please.
Thank you. Good day, Mr. Chairman, honored representatives, and ladies and gentlemen. I have great respect for our system of government, and you define the system so very well. It is indeed an honor and a privilege for me to testify before you and your distinguished colleagues, and I thank you. On July 17, 1996, our daughter Kimberly, age 17, and our only child fell 2.5 miles to the burning surface of the Atlantic Ocean. the result of an aviation disaster of horrendous proportions in which 229 other people lost their lives as well. TWA Flight 800 exploded at approximately 8:31 p.m., and it altered my wife's and my lives in ways we never thought possible. We've had to learn to adapt to a life without a child. We've grown more able to apply the necessary social makeup and show the emotions that people expect of us. While outwardly smiling, the torrent of tears continues to flow within us. Being a stoic while you spiritually and emotionally bleed to death is not easy. We try to cope and have succeeded fairly well thus far, but for us, closure is a word that isn't in the dictionary. It doesn't exist for us. It can never be. At the same time, we do not ask for pity, nor do we want it. There are countless others who are far worse off than we. I will not immerse myself in self-pity either. Kim would not want us to leap from a cliff into a yawning chasm of self-inflicted sorrow, but to climb the cliff and try to make a positive from a negative, and so we shall. Kim was that way. She was also a National Honor Society student, a member of several school clubs, a soccer player, and a teacher of little ones, a school-appointed member of the Lycoming County Historical Society, community participant, and one of the gentlest and kindest souls I have ever known. Kim always gave, she never took. She was sharp of mind and had enough credits to have graduated as a junior. I'm a brittle diabetic, which means I can't control my sugar levels very well, and I have several associative diseases as a result of diabetes. Twice, she saved me from what would most certainly have been a diabetic coma. What has the loss of her companionship meant to me? Everything. She was my nurse and cared for me with all that she had. She cannot be replaced, and I have no one else left to take care of me. I lost my best friend and the person who loved me unconditionally as I loved her in return. How many people can ever be that fortunate? But now everything is gone. On July 6, 1989, Natalie Calhoun, beloved daughter of Lucian and Robin Calhoun, residents of Pennsylvania, was killed while riding a jet ski manufactured by Yamaha while in territorial waters off the coast of Puerto Rico. She was a credit to her grief-stricken family and to her community, I'm sure, just as Kim was to us. In a decision handed down on January 9, 1995, Yamaha versus Calhoun, the United States Supreme Court ruled that the Calhouns could recover damages under U.S. law and using a court system, which is all Americans' birthright. Because Natalie so tragically died within less than a marine league from the Puerto Rican shores. Exactly 1 week later, this same court decided in Zykerman versus Korean Airlines that the DOSHA written in 1920, in an age before transoceanic flight even existed, would be applied to a KAL-007 victim's family, thus negating any ability to recover any non-pecuniary damages within the United States court system. Does one's life become worthless after crossing an invisible line on the ocean's floor? Are we only map coordinates, or are we human beings? Does this mean that we no longer have the dignity and virtues that any other human being has or had before crossing this line? No, I think not. In fact, the United States Supreme Court, as well as the Gore Commission, have asked Congress to remedy this inequity that surrounds death both on land, within a marine league of our shores, as well as a tragic death on international waters. This law has been corrupted for selfish use. This law was originally intended to benefit families, not to steal away their right to their just due, death. As we have so sadly learned, whether you're young or old, black or white, breadwinner or child, the Grim Reaper does not choose favorites, nor should we, by virtue of an archaic law from an age before aircraft ever flew between the continents. Why wouldn't death be equal? It's the ultimate equality. Death is death, no matter where it occurs. The Death on the High Seas Act is like an albatross around the shoulders of Lady Justice. We have come to relieve that burden, to lighten her load, and we shall do it. We ask all men and all women of good conscience to help us to do that. Our children were people of fine character and dignity, some far better than many adults who I've met. Help us to retain the sanctity of life and in the restoration of equality for the victims and their families of all tragedies which occur at sea. We have come to only because of the immense efforts of Congressman McDade, his 42 co-sponsors, and our Senators Specter and Santorum to tell you of their fight for us. We have asked and they have responded. In a classic case of government at work for and with its people, they have done and continue to do everything in their power to help us. Our great thanks to you, Congressman Duncan, a major supporter of the Aviation and Family Assistance Act, for bringing this bill to the attention of the committee in such a rapid and timely manner. Thank you, Mr. Chairman, for affording us this opportunity to be here so swiftly. Our daughter Kim is a human being, not a ticket stub. I ask all of you to honor her accomplishments as a human being and to treat her with the respect she deserves. She was a living, loving young woman and our child, not a piece of flotsam, her life brutally ended. We will not allow her to be declared worthless and simply discarded because of what has now become an inhumane 77-year-old law, out of time and out of place. In closing, I ask for the unanimous passage of House Bill H.R. 2005 as originally introduced. Thank you for allowing me to sit before you and speak. It was my honor to be here today. This is my oral testimony. I respectfully ask of you to allow my lengthier written testimony to be made a part of the congressional record. Thank you.
Mr. Rogers, thank you very much. And the statements of all of the panel in which I had read these before I came in here, although I did not get to hear some of the witnesses present them. But I can tell you, Mr. Rogers, I have one of my children is a daughter who was 17 at the time of this horrible tragedy, and she's 18 now. And I was fortunate to grow up in a close family and have a close family now. And I can't fully comprehend the loss that each of you have suffered. I don't suppose anybody could who has not been through that. But I can relate to some extent, thinking of my own children, at the horror that you all have been through. And I can tell you that there are many, many people in this Congress who want to try to do everything possible that we can, not only to help you, but to see that things like this don't happen again. Despite our best efforts, I'm sure they will, but we want to make sure that they happen as infrequently as is humanly possible. And I appreciate, more than I could say in just a few brief words, the fact that each of you would come here today and testify, because I know this draws back up memories that are very, very painful. And I know this is not an easy thing to do. But I think it's something that that hopefully will be very, very important for many years to come. And so I appreciate your testimony. And now we'll hear from Mr. Ephraimson-Abt.
Mr. Chairman, my name is Cynthia E. Ephraimson-Abt, and I'm the father of Alice Ephraimson-Abt, who perished at the age 23 on September 1st, 1983, with 268 passengers and crew from 15 countries when a Soviet fighter plane disabled Korean Airlines Flight 007. After a 12-minute descent, KAL 007 crashed into the sea, broke apart, and sank with all of its passengers alive into the sea, and the passengers drowned. None of our loved ones were ever recovered. We are still looking for their remains. For the last 12 years, I'm also the chairman of the American Association for Families of KAL-07 Victims, a support group that has extended its activities to assist families involved in other air accidents to cope better with their tragedies aftermath. We also participate actively in the efforts to improve after crisis management, as well as to update and modernize laws and treaties. We support comprehensive regulations where needed to improve domestic and international civil litigation. Mr. Chairman, next to me is sitting Nicola Truppen. Nicola Truppen and her sister Andrea lost their father, an international renowned gynecologist, and she has come all the way from Boston. She has two children, she has a job, to appear for you and next to me. She was the first chairman of our organization and only retired to take care of her family because she was in need of a job. She has done a much better job than I did and I'm doing, and I wish she still would head our organization. Congress has cared greatly. It has shown unfailing concern with the plight of air crash victims and has enacted reasonable legislation such as the Aviation Security Improvement Act of 1996 in the aftermath of 1990 in the aftermath of Pan American 103 Lockerbie tragedy. Last year, after the value jet crash, the Aviation Disaster Family Assistance Act of 1996 was introduced. It became law under your chairman's leadership. The Secretary of Transportation is already chairing a task force to proceed with the law's implementation. The National Transportation Safety Board has actively and successfully assumed its added role, assigned to it by the President and by Congress, to coordinate aviation crisis management. We know of no government agency that has implemented a law with such speed, vim, vigor, dedication, sensitivity, gusto, and as yet minimal funding. And I would like to mention that I was privileged to be asked to join the TWA 800 families at Kennedy Airport, and I was privileged to relate to them ever since. I've never seen agencies like the FBI and the National Transportation Board and other agencies work in such lockstep as in the TWA 800 after crisis relationship with families and with their investigation, and I think we, all of the families, want to compliment them for their concerns. Regretfully, in the press of other legislative business, the Death on the High Seas Act issues were not addressed by the 104th Congress, but when the TWA 800 families and ourselves brought the urgent need for legislation recommended by the Supreme Court and by the Gore Commission to the attention of Congress 2 months ago, Congressman McDade, whose constituents are the families of the high school children of Montoursville, Pennsylvania, now joined by over 40 bipartisan co-sponsors, introduced the Airlines Disaster Relief Act, H.R. 2005, which was assigned to the House Aviation Subcommittee, and an identical bill, S-943, was introduced in the Senate by Senators Specter and Santoro. Again, you, Mr. Chairman, actively supported the legislation by scheduling a hearing at the shortest possible notice. We would like to thank you, Mr. Chairman, Congressman McDade, the President, we hope the future sponsors of H.R. 205, Congressman Schuster, the Chairman of the Transportation Committee, Congressman Oberstar and Lipinski, the Ranking Committee and Subcommittee members, and their dedicated staffs for their efforts and for their support. Your staff smiles on us, and your support lifts our hearts. We express my family's gratitude to our representative, Congressman Raukema, who from the time Ellis was taken from us under such brutal circumstances 14 years ago, has been a caring friend and a staunch supporter of all of the families of tragedies that have occurred since then. And I want to correct Congressman Raukema's remark today. It was she who was then in Germany and had meetings with the Bundesbank, who tried very tenuously to reach me to extend her hand and her heart to my family and give us solace over the oceans. We also appreciate Congressman Menendez's interest and support as soon as our concerns were brought to his attention. The Death on the High Seas Act of 1920 was passed by the 66th Congress to give damages to widows of seamen who perished in international waters when workmen's compensation or other remedies were not available. In 1920, civil aviation transport was in its infancy. The Supreme Court in the Zickerman decision of 1996, 77 years later, applied the Death on the High Seas Act to take away damages awarded to an elderly, impecunious mother of an air crash victim that occurred more than 3 miles from the shores by allowing full economic and non-economic damages under a separate decision to state tort law to a family whose daughter died in an accident within coastal waters that is less than 3 miles from the shores. The Death on the High Seas Act is about Muriel Mihalik, the mother of Muriel Cole, who perished with flight KL-07 on September 1, 1983. Muriel is a proud 77-year-old devout subway token clerk, now retired from the New York Metropolitan Transit Authority, with a monthly pension of $400, living in a walk-up in Brooklyn, New York. She worked diligently, often on double shifts of 16 hours, in a stuffy, stale, drafty, noisy, smelly underground cubicle, long before modern security, proper lighting, and air conditioning were installed. Her job was one fraught with danger. Today, Muriel Mihalik goes to church every day to pray for the soul of her daughter, whose remains were never recovered. She has no grave to visit. On a bleak Friday afternoon in December 92, during one of the heaviest snowstorms that paralyzed New York, Muriel Mihalik was awarded $28,000 for the death of her daughter. In January 1996, over 13 years after the death of Muriel Cole, the Supreme Court took Muriel Mihalik's $28,000 award away from her as not recoverable under the Death on the High Seas Act, just because her daughter had perished more than 3 miles from the shores. Had her daughter been a victim in an automobile accident in Brooklyn, Muriel Mihalik would have been entitled to full economic and non-economic damages. Before its timely end, flight KL-07 circled for 12 minutes partially over the land of two islands, as well as within and outside of the 3 mile watery boundary that is a threshold of the difference between state tort law and the restrictions of the Death on the High Seas Act. Fate had it that the plane finally crashed into the sea outside of the 3 mile limit. Had Pan American Flight 103 been on time, it would have exploded over the high seas, with the Death on the High Seas Act applying to its passengers, including the 30 Syracuse University students. Because Pan American 103 was behind schedule, it crashed over land. KL-07, Pan American 103, TWA-800 is the right to damages measured by fate. Muriel Cole would have attended to her mother in her old age. She would not have had to live in a walk-up in Brooklyn alone, uncared for. But now Muriel Mihalik, with a meager MTA pension of $400 and Social Security, grieving for the loss of her daughter whose remains have not been recovered, can only look forward to end her life as a Medicaid patient at public charge and expense. In 1983, and I'm through very soon, a Korean Airlines carried liability insurance coverage of $400 million per flight. In 1989, our courts found Korean Airlines liable for damages because of its willful misconduct. Yet, under the Death on the High Seas Act, there is nothing available to afford Muriel Mihalik the quality and the dignity of care this hardworking woman would have been entitled to and her daughter could have provided her with had she been alive. Mr. Chairman, every day all passengers whose flights are taking off while approaching any of our airports on the eastern and western seaboards, flying more than 3 miles beyond our shores, are potential victims of the Death on the ICs Act. No time should be lost to restore equality among the passenger rights. And I want to point you to you the letter the Air Transport Association submitted to your committee supporting the abolition of the Death on the High Seas Act in aviation cases, but opposing retroactivity to the TWA 800 families. In fact, Section 109 of Title I in the U.S. Code, which is cited in this letter, specifically says that Congress can enact the retroactivity to the TWA 800 families, because it says that retroactivity should not apply absent of clear language to the contrary. The clear language of HR 2005 allows the extension of American tort law to the TWA 800 families. Follow the Supreme Court's and the Gore Commission's recommendations to provide equal treatment for all victims and their families wherever their tragedies occur. I submit to you more fully my written statement, which is a little more elaborate, and this concludes my testimony. I thank you, Mr. Chairman, for allowing me this overtime and for your attention.
Mr. Ephraimson-Abt, thank you very much for your testimony. I guess I have several thoughts, but one is to say that $28,000 for the death of a daughter seems to me to be a great insult. And then to have the Supreme Court take even that meager award away is adding great injury to great insult, in my opinion. It's obvious that you loved your daughter very, very much to come here almost 14 years after her tragic death and testify in the way that you have in hopes of helping others. I was interested to hear Mr. Rogers say that in his opinion there is no word such as closure in the dictionary, and it seems to me that that is a word that is now being overused, and it seems to be used most often by people who I suppose mean well, but they are usually people who have not had to undergo what each of you have had to undergo, because I know that these events will be with you, each of you, for the rest of your lives. But as I said earlier, I hope that we can help at least in a small way. I thank you again very much for your testimony, and at this time I will go to Mr. Peace for any questions that or comments that he might have. All right. Mr. Lipinski.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I simply want to thank all the witnesses for coming here and testifying. I know how difficult it has to be for you. And once again, I express my sympathies and condolences to all of you. And I'm sure that very shortly we will take some action to at least start moving towards some justice for you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Mr. Lipinski. Dr. Cooksey.
I, too, want to share my sympathy. I'm a pilot, have been for 30 years, and I think every time I fly, I know there's a risk involved, and yet there are accidents, and they're always tragic. A question that I would like to ask of the staff is a monetary question, or perhaps someone here knows the answer. What would be the likely financial difference if this bill was passed? What is the likeness? You said there was $28,000 in your case. Had this been within the 3 mile limit, what would it have been? Has anyone done that, or does anyone know the answer to that?
excuse me, maybe I can answer it. The Death on the High Seas Act was enacted in order to allow widows of seamen to get some losses for their pecuniary damages, which means a widow which loses a wage earner. Naturally, if elderly people were not necessarily always dependent on their children yet, or children who are growing up and are not providing for their to their family's income, under the Death on the High Seas Act would get nothing. And in international accidents, where we have, in addition, the Warsaw Convention, where you have to prove first liability with a very high threshold, which is willful misconduct. And willful misconduct in the over 70 years of the Warsaw Convention has only been proven 10 times. So you have two thresholds. You have the threshold of to prove willful misconduct, otherwise you have a cap of $75,000. Now can a widow live with $75,000 with children? And then suddenly you have full liability, and if the death occurs 3.01 mile from the shores, the law says then you have to have another threshold of the Death on the High Seas Act, and anybody who has not suffered provable economic damages is getting nothing.
That gives me some insight. Another question, and again, perhaps it's a question to staff. What is done in, say, Great Britain, France, Germany, under the same circumstances?
In the first place, as the Supreme Court noticed, and Judge Scalia noticed, many countries don't have a Death on the High Seas Act, so they have full liability. In the second place, Congressman, those countries have a very high level of social services. Britain has, for instance, in Pan American 103, even the American families who were involved in Pan American 103 had the right to obtain pensions under the social security system, which then were repaid when they got damages in this country. But those pensions are fairly high and compensate to what you would get in this country where we don't have a social security system which gives you pensions, would replace the income of their husbands or would give you some kind of bereavement money like insurance companies do. But we don't have that system in this country. So the only way we families can recoup some of their damages is by getting damages actions in courts and court-educated awards under within their way of or way of life or within their income.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
I hope it's clear.
That answers my question.
Sure.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Very much, Dr. Cooksey. Mr. Blunt.
Mr. Chairman, I want to thank you again for having this hearing today. As I said when you were gone, the chairman has really done a great job with the committee in both the private hearings and lots of discussions, keeping us on track with this tragedy. This is our first public hearing today, and certainly family members coming. Mr. Ephraimson-Abt, you coming and sharing your experience, which has gone on even longer, has been a helpful part of this today, and we are grateful to you. I know that this will never be over, and there's really nothing we can say that will make it over or make it any better. We will remember you in our prayers and remember the families and what they deal with every day. And I know that no kind of compensation would ever be adequate, and this is just something that you'll have to live with, and we will pray that you'll have the strength to live with it.
Mr. Chairman, could I just supplement my answer? Thank you, Congressman, for your kind words. May I just supplement my answer to Congressman Cooksey? when Victoria Cumming and I were at Kennedy Airport, we had several meetings with the president of TWA, Mr. Erickson, and we pointed out to him the questions of the Death on the ICs Act and also the question of the Warsaw Convention. And we also made him aware that, for instance, American Airlines, in the case of the Carly incident, had waived voluntarily the limits of the Warsaw Convention and went right to damages. And we encouraged him to do the same thing. Unfortunately, the attorneys of TWA 800 have not followed that path and have preserved their rights under Warsaw and DOSA very effectively.
Well, thank you very much, Mr. Ellers.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I do not have any specific questions for this panel since I have been chasing around several other committee meetings. I do simply want to make a suggestion for the record, Mr. Chairman. And we had a hearing on an issue related to this last year, and it appears to me that there's a terrible problem dealing with the liability of the airlines after an accident. There are multiple lawsuits filed. A great deal of time, effort, and money is spent in the courts on attorneys in a situation where people are grieving. And it seems to me a much better approach in situations like this where it's very difficult to establish any particular culpability that we should consider legislation which would establish a standard payment that airlines would make to relatives of passengers in any case where there is an accident that is where the airline is at fault, and that this standardized payment be adopted in this nation for accidents within our border, and perhaps persuade other airlines to adopt it on an international basis. It would save a tremendous amount of time, litigation, and anguish on the part of the people involved, and would be a far better way of dealing with it without the difficulties we currently face. And I simply wanted to get that suggestion on the record, Mr. Chairman.
Well, thank you very much, Dr. Ellers. Certainly that's something we can look into. Mr. Watts?
I have no questions, Mr. Chairman.
All right. Well, thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen, for being here with us today. Your testimony and your assistance has been greatly appreciated and very helpful and encouraging to us. And we will take a very brief recess while the staff sets out some materials and call some members, and we will then proceed with the markup on the two bills that we have before us this afternoon. Thank you very much.
Thank you,
that
Mr.
concludes
Chairman.
This hearing.
Investigators still do not know what caused the explosion of TWA Flight 800. They say several theories remain under consideration.